This is the Buzz Adams Morning Show podcast. Barstool Talk Daily. Except it's really early in the morning and no booze. For the most part.
Adams Morning Show, Monday through Friday, 5 to 10. KLEQ and KLEQ HD1, El Paso, a Town Square media station.
What day is it?
What am I going to do, make a big announcement? Big announcement, everybody.
It's Wednesday.
Up and at 'em.
Everybody works on Wednesday.
Who are these people?
Who are these people?
These are idiots.
Not exactly the best and brightest.
These people are not rocket scientists.
Okay, I get it. The gloves are off.
These are just ordinary, boring people.
All right.
You seem like a lunatic.
Let's do this.
Showtime.
Get ready.
All right, here we go, everybody.
Here we go.
Now.
The Buzz Adams Morning Show is back.
Here we go.
On 95.5 KLAQ.
All right. Thank you very much. Thank you. Good morning and welcome, everybody, to the show. It is Wednesday morning.
Woo-hoo!
And we do have a guest on the show today. Actor Michael Rappaport and his wife, Kibi, do a show called Rappaport Reality. And it is them talking about reality television, but like in such a deep fan way. Like you go in and they're talking about, did you see what Lala did? And then Ariana came out and said this to her. And then Tom S. did this. And LVP was all like, it's like, I mean, it would be like tuning in to a sports talk show and you've never heard of sports before.
Right.
You know.
Like they know the stats of all the housewives.
They know the status. They know the stats. They know everything about what's going on. So, which is interesting because I think Michael Rappaport is a bit, well, at least he was a big sports fan. I don't know how you watch any sports if you got to keep up with all the reality stuff that he does. But Michael Rappaport is going to be on the show coming up a little bit later. You know him from movies like Copland and Higher Education. And he was just on that Fallout that was on Netflix recently.
Mm-hmm.
Based on a video game, I think.
It is.
good morning, Nico Ajimian.
Good morning.
How you feeling? How's the tummy tum? How's the rum tum tugger?
There's no way if you had told like 15, 20, 25-year-old Nico that he was going to get heartburn, that would be immobilizing.
Debilitating case of heartburn, huh?
Bad
that you would consider it in the GERD range?
Yeah.
Wait, do you have a diagnosis of gastrointestinal reflux disorder?
I do, actually.
Okay.
So, Nico is feeling old. Joanna, no more coffee for me.
Uh-oh.
Yeah.
You know what? You really need to cut out coffee. Smoking.
Yeah, that's number one trigger.
I got to figure quitting smoking is a good option for anybody.
It is, yep, top of the priority list.
And booze.
Yeah, we'll see about that one.
That's probably not doing you any favors,
man. No, I'm just kidding. Yeah, no, definitely the smoking. Honestly, that's like the number one thing. Who knew? That's bad for you.
Smoking was bad
for
you.
Yeah, seriously. Yeah.
State Line Patio Concert Series continues tonight. There's a free concert every Wednesday night happening at the State Line Restaurant out on their shady patio. That is State Line Restaurant, 1222 Sunland Park Drive. And you can get there at 6. You eat out on the patio. It's already nice and cool by that time. The way they have the patio set up, it's real shady out there. And Glenn Garz is going to be your host tonight. He's going to be bringing some prizes to give away. And you can enjoy some tasty barbecue, raise an ice cold beverage, win some free stuff, and enjoy some fine music on the State Line patio stage. You can read all about it at klaq.com. That's klaq.com to find out more. And why don't we go ahead and get a look at the weather? I know we're going to be up around 100 or even in excess of 100 for this week. We also have some rain moving in later in the week. So here you go. This is the Golfers Forecast brought to you by Painted Dunes Desert Golf Course. Partly cloudy today. 104 for the high temperature. Hardly any wind, though. So just if it's just the heat. Otherwise, I'm going to say pretty good day for golf, all things considered. Tomorrow, it is even going to be warmer. Listen to this. This will be our new high so far in 2024, if we get there. 106 for tomorrow's high temperature. Sweltering. Also, chance of afternoon rain. We're going to put in a 15 to 20% chance rain in the afternoon tomorrow. Likewise, we have rain on Friday, but that is not going to cool things down much. Friday is going to be 104, and we are looking for a 20-30% chance of rain Friday afternoon, then overnight Friday into Saturday. Weekend also looks warm, 102 on Saturday, 98, maybe a little bit of a break there by Sunday. And El Paso weather, the Golfers Forecast, brought to you by Painted Dunes Desert Golf Course. You can set up all your tee times and reservations online at PaintedDunes.com. That's PaintedDunes.com. Or call the Pro Shop. Their number is 915-821-2122 for Painted Dunes Desert Golf Course. Let's start with Joanna. Joanna's going to tell us what's coming up in the Hollywood Cheese Made today. Good morning.
Good morning.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi there.
Hello.
You tell me what's coming up.
Yeah, I don't
know. So I don't play the same thing.
Oh, okay. I don't know who thought this was a good idea, and I don't know who asked for this, but Alec Baldwin is doing a family reality show with his wife, Hilaria, and there's seven kids.
Seven kids.
Right.
She lost her Spanish accent, I noticed.
Yes, there was.
I was listening
no
to the
Spanish.
Clip. There was no Spanish accent at all.
Right.
It's amazing how quickly you lose an accent when you've been faking it.
Alec
the whole
and
time.
Hilaria. And their seven kids will have a show called The Baldwins, and it'll air on TLC sometime next year.
Okay, so Alec Baldwin,
Hilaria,
and their children. Now, when do they start shooting?
Hey.
I'm sorry.
Oh, no. I don't that know is, if shooting has already begun.
Is that seven kids not counting the not kids that he had with Kim Basinger?
Yeah, not counting that rude, thoughtless little pig.
Ireland.
Yeah. Ireland, the rude,
no
thoughtless little pig.
If, she'll be on the show as well.
Where's this chaos going to air?
TLC. Where else?
Right. No kidding.
Home of 1,000-Pound Sisters and others.
I got to write this down if we interview Michael Rapaport. So you guys in for...
Oh, yeah.
What's the show, Baldwin show?
The Baldwins.
Just the Baldwins.
Just the Baldwins.
So you're going to ask him about several reality shows?
What their podcast is about.
I bet you Michael Rapaport's been in something with a Baldwin. I'm not saying Alec.
Yeah, probably.
I mean, Alec is kind of the golden ring, but I bet he's been in something with Billy. Or Steven.
Steven, yeah. Everybody's been in a movie with Steven.
Nico, Jimmy and has our news headlines on the way. Nico, what's coming up in news?
Lots of news today. It's the second day of Hunter Biden's trial. So we're going to see more of what's going on surrounding that. Also, Attorney General Merrick Garland was grilled by a congressional committee yesterday.
You know, I saw some of the clips of that, and he really, you know, stood up and said, hey, listen, you guys are causing threats to be made against career civil servants and government employees, and you need to knock it off. So he kind of gave it back to the committee as much as he got it.
Right.
Nico's going to be out this Saturday. Join Nico from 3 to 5 at Horizon Vista Market.
Yeah.
And it is that new 8 Elite Light Lager, Troy Aikman's new beer, 8 Elite
Light Lager. 8 Elite Light, Light Lager. Lager. 8 Elite, Elite Light Lager.
It's made with 100% organic grains, no cheap fillers, with only 90 calories and 2.6 grams of carbs. 8 Elite is truly light beer made right. Just for stopping in, we got some gear to give away. 8 Elite gear. Also, you might win an NFL gift card. We've got $50 NFL gift cards that we'll be giving away. That is Nico at Horizon Vista Market, 121 North Canazo, and that is Saturday from 3 to 5.
Mm-hmm. Also, I've got trivia today. I'm going to be at Silo Bar. It starts at 7 p.m., and it's going to be full of great prizes, fun times, delicious drinks.
Silo Bar's at the substation?
At the substation, yeah.
That is corner of Sunset and Donovan, I say.
You know, I was going to tell you, I've hung out with Michael Rappaport in a green room before.
No.
Yeah.
Where?
In L.A. at the Laugh Factory.
Does he do stand-up?
He does stand-up.
Oh, I didn't know he did stand-up.
I think he might have started in stand-up. Well, I'm not sure actually how he got into stand-up, but yeah.
I don't know how Derek wrote. I don't know how Derek knows. Fair warning, Michael Rappaport is prickly.
Oh, he's just famous for it.
For what?
For, like, posting videos of himself commenting about being prickly about stuff.
Just prickly?
Yeah.
About, like, what? Parking?
Yeah.
Things like that?
Yeah.
Okay. Something tells me we'll get along.
Well, just great. Fine. Yeah. How's Jer Bear?
Jer, so, okay. So, for those of you not interested, I'll just take 30 seconds here. One of my German Shepherds had a stroke, like full-on stroke. He got up. He was walking around a little bit yesterday, not on his own, but like with a little help. And every now and then you'll go outside, you'll realize, oh, my God, he went from over there all the way to his little dog loo, which is like an igloo for dogs. And so somehow he's getting around. I wish I caught him standing up on all fours.
On all fours?
Yeah, on all fours the other day, which is...
That's amazing.
He's making pretty incredible progress. In about an hour, if you wouldn't mind going over and giving him his pills, that'd be great. You can leave the show to go over and give
him... I can go do that for him.
all right, we're going to get into Today in Sound Clips coming up here in just a few moments. Michael Rappaport... actor and apparently prickly person, Michael Rappaport, is going to be on the show coming up later.
The Daily Calendar.
Today, June 5th.
It's World Environment Day, so get out there and don't globally warm stuff.
I wasn't gonna.
Well, all right then. It's also Hot Air Balloon Day. What did I just tell you?
Oh, yeah, sorry.
It's Gingerbread Day. Makes perfect sense. It's nowhere near Christmas. And it's Jenny, Janet, and Joyce Day to honor the whole HR department.
Hi. You're late.
And that's your daily calendar.
Hey, this is Daniel Paulus. I'll be along starting at 3 with everything from Ozzy to
Visit Jody Law Firm. City of El Paso every day. Call 915-444-1000 for your free consultation.
Originating in El Paso, for El Paso, the Buzz Adams Morning Show, 95.5 KLAQ.
Just about to get into Today in Sound Clips. I have all of the day's news coming up for you. And then later on the show, Michael Rappaport, the actor, is going to be joining us, along with his wife, Kibi. They are the current reality television it couple?
They are.
They're not on a reality show, but they have a podcast called Rappaport Reality. Brings back memories. I remember when I was with some chick who always wanted to watch reality TV. It was gets your claws in you.
You could have started a podcast then.
Yeah, right.
There's only been like so I can tell you the reality shows that I ever really got invested in. The very first season of Survivor, all the way back in 2000. Like, I was all in on that.
Uh-huh. You were in on The Bachelor. What are you talking about?
The Bachelor,
about?
But only if I have a girlfriend.
It sounded like you were into it even when you weren't.
Well, it's kind of a compromise. Because I want to watch golf on Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. So the compromise is I watch whatever reality crap she's into. Whoever she may be during the week, right?
You're such a good boyfriend.
Yeah.
That's about as far as I go. Like, I'm not going to pick up my socks or anything. And now Alec Baldwin is doing a family reality show on TLC, we just found out. We are going to have a great dining deal this week, and it's a real El Paso landmark, an institution. That's track ones starting Friday at 10 a.m. Oh, yeah. The way we work with dining deals through seizethedeal.com, we have to offer $50 food certificates, but you only pay $25 for them. Now, there's a catch. We only print up 100 of them. So as soon as that 100 is finished, they're gone. And track one has takeout. Or you can go and sit in their famous railroad. Isn't it like a railroad car? Or right. It's a railroad car.
Do you like going there, Joanna?
I do, yeah. The other day that we all went from the office, we were like at the caboose of it.
You got to sit in the caboose?
Yeah.
From mouth-watering burgers to their famous double-dipped wings, your next dining adventure should be at track one. Order takeout. Enjoy your favorites at home or work. From sizzling wings to savory bites, their menu brings you the taste of track one. Visit track1elpaso.com to place your order. And on Friday, we're going to have 100 certificates. Everybody can buy up to two of them, and they're both $25 for $50 food certificates. Take advantage of this dining deal starting Friday at 10 a.m. Go to klaq.com. You can find out more. Click dining deals on the must-read bar at klaq.com. Or the Dining Deals button on the KLAQ mobile app. Coming up, I've got random facts on the way for you this morning. I'm going to have to talk about a two-year-old who's selling his artwork or her artwork, I'm not sure, for $7,000.
Is it really her selling it or is it her parents?
Well, definitely, I think her parents are making the financial, you know. This is like when Hunter Biden started selling his artwork, I feel like. All right, time to do sound clips.
And now, today in sound clips.
All of the day's news with accompanying sound bites and actualities. Let's talk about some major immigration executive orders coming from the White House yesterday. President Joe Biden took action on immigration yesterday. Biden signed an executive order that will temporarily shut down asylum requests when the average number of daily border crossings goes over 2,500. An administration official said that a shutdown would be required immediately when you reach that 2,500 threshold. And it has already been met. So immediately the shutdown is going to be underway. The shutdown will last until the number of encounters at the border drops to 1,500 per day. So here we go. While announcing his new executive order tightening the immigration policy on the Mexico border, President Joe Biden took a swipe at Republicans for not having done something.
I've come here today to do what the Republicans in Congress refuse to do, take the necessary steps to secure our border.
Now, Biden is getting criticized from both sides. You've got the Republicans who are saying, well, you could have done this all along. You should have just, you know, you're just doing this because we're getting close to the election. And then you got people on his left who are saying this is a real step backwards for Joe Biden to be copying some of Trump's policies from when he was in the White House.
I say use what works and get rid of what doesn't work. If this is something that's going to help Border Patrol agents, Custom and Border Patrol agents, then they should do it.
I mean, I think there are a lot of people here. Okay, 2,500 seems like a lot, but 1,500 sounds like a lot too.
Yeah.
You know, 1,500 sounds like a lot of people coming in all the time.
I can't believe Democrats on the left would criticize him for this.
You think Democrats should be more supportive?
Absolutely. If Democrats come off as looking like they are against any type of measure, even if it may be hearken to a Trump era measure or anything like that, if it's effective, do it.
I mean, the idea, okay, so you're going to hear Mike Johnson. He's going to talk about Biden being for open borders. Biden's not for open borders. There are people that are for open borders. I mean, those people exist in America. You acknowledge that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Who just believe people should just come and go, for that there really should not be a border.
I don't think that's the majority, but yeah.
No, it's not, but there are some. So let's hear from Republican Speaker of the House Mike Johnson, who says that he's not impressed with Biden's immigration moves.
He can close the border down entirely. He's not going to do that. He has no interest in doing that. They want it wide open. So this weak measure here, don't be fooled.
This really again, let's define what wide open is.
Right.
Wide open is you would just let anybody walk in without asking to see any papers. And there are some people on the far left who want that.
But isn't it interesting that that's their entire messaging is to say, oh, he's really for these open borders. He wants a wide open border.
Well, listen,
and he comes out with a policy that's about closing the border. The whole policy is closing the border.
No, we can see right through this. He really wants open borders.
He really wants open borders, okay. But even though he's closing borders with this.
So let's hear from the other side. On the left flank, Democrat Representative Nanette Berrigan.
Nanette.
Let me just go back to Mike Johnson, the Republicans, here just for a second. The ACLU's already said they're going to challenge this. This is going to get tied up in the courts. You know what happened to Trump's policies?
The same.
Largely got tied up in the courts. That's why they wanted congressional action, because if you enact it as law, as legislation, you can circumvent the courts if it's passed by your legislative branch. You remember earlier this year, Biden had this, and they said, well, this doesn't do anything. The president can do whatever they want to. Well, you saw Trump try that. And some of the stuff he got away with for a while, but it always got bogged down in the courts with groups like the ACLU taking up the cause. Democrat Representative Nanette Berrigan of California said that this new Biden policy toward the border is a step backwards.
It's not a time for us to turn to Trump-era policies. It's not time to go and use the tools that Trump used.
I mean, it is if it helps. All right. Any Democrat or anybody on the left side or anybody that's liberal should say, we have a problem. You would, anybody on the left side would have to admit that there was a crisis on the border, humanitarian crisis.
Oh, I talk to people all the time who will say the only crisis is that we are not passing out work visas left and right to everybody who wants to come in. I mean, as far right as you can imagine somebody being on immigration, like set up machine gun turrets.
Yeah.
There are people that far on the left.
No, I get that. I just think they should be marginalized.
Well, they are. They're on the margins. That's exactly. Anybody who's extreme right, that's a margin. Anybody who's extreme left, that's a margin. I usually find in most things, not just policy or politics, but in most things, the middle is a good place to be. Attorney General Merrick Garland was in the hot seat Tuesday, testifying before the House Judiciary Committee. The Republican-led committee is claiming the Justice Department's recent investigations are politically motivated. Garland, in his opening statement, said Republicans' accusations, theories, conspiracies, and rhetoric are creating a dangerous environment for DOJ officials and everyday employees, but that the Department of Justice will not be intimidated by such tactics.
We are seeing heinous threats of violence being directed at the Justice Department's career civil servants. These repeated attacks on the Justice Department are unprecedented and they are unfounded. These attacks have not and they will not influence our decision making.
Attorney General Merrick Garland testifying there before the House Judiciary Committee. Both he and Republicans on the committee had some harsh words for both sides. Several Republican lawmakers have threatened to hold Garland in contempt of Congress for withholding information from special counsel Robert Hur's investigation into President Joe Biden's classified documents case. You've heard about this story, right?
No.
Yes, you have. They want to see, you remember Robert Hur came out, some of the takeaways there were Joe Biden seems to be a slightly befuddled but well-meaning older man, and we've decided not to bring charges against him for this, that, and whatever other reason. So, Republicans seem most interested in the audio of Special Counsel Robert Hur's interviews with Biden. Garland again saying, I will not be intimidated.
Right. And imagine this. Imagine anybody who's under investigation for anything. If your political enemies found the audio for your interrogation by the police, they would find something to make you look bad. What I'm saying is this isn't very bad faith. There's no reason why you would want the interviews, the audio from a police investigation or a special counsel's investigation, unless you just wanted to make the person look bad.
The investigation had to rely on testimony from a lot of people. And usually what you do not want, if you want somebody to testify truthfully, is publishing the report. Let's hear from Representative Jim Jordan, who is the chairman of the House Judiciary Committee, said that he told Merrick Garland there's a double justice system.
Many Americans believe there's now a double standard in our justice system. They believe that because there is.
There has always been a double standard in the judicial system. I wish that some of these people would acknowledge this all through the years.
Right. Hot or not.
Yeah, if you don't have enough money, you're probably going to get a public defender. And if you're rich, it seems like you can almost get away with anything if you hire enough lawyers and good enough lawyers.
Oh, I thought you were going to say if you're pretty, you could get away with anything.
There are many double justice standards. Yes. And that is one. Pretty privilege is one, but I don't think that's what he was talking about. Here's Garland explaining. He says that releasing the Biden audio, which is what the Republicans want, could have a negative effect on other investigations.
It could influence witnesses' answers if they thought the audio of their law enforcement interviews would be broadcast to Congress and the public.
Yeah, you know, normally when you're talking with a special counsel, you don't think that you all of a sudden are going to be in the spotlight for something that you said to a special counsel.
I think for any interview with a law enforcement authority, you wouldn't want that to be automatically published. Well, in any case, really.
You're supposed to know ahead of time what's on the record, what's off the record, what's on the record for the purposes of this investigation,
right,
and what's off the record for public consumption. They finally got Wi-Fi to a remote tribe in the Amazon jungle.
I was going to bring this up to you.
Oh.
Is this in the prep?
You're damn right it is.
God, I'm so good at getting news.
A remote Brazilian tribe deep in the Amazon rainforest was recently able to access the internet for the first time, thanks to the satellite Starlink service. So how are the people in the tribe spending their hours? Are they learning about the world outside and finding out what these amazing flying machines over their heads are?
Nope.
They just kind of veg out and look at the internet just like Americans do.
Porn.
Porn is definitely part of it. 9 months ago, a remote tribe in the Amazon was given high-speed internet. People say people in the tribe say that it's making the young people lazy and that even grown-ups only want to be on the internet. They're also dealing with people watching videos of graphic sex, you know, like everybody with the internet does.
In 9 months, all it took was 9 months.
Here is Jack Nikas of the New York Times, who visited the tribe. Here he is talking about what he saw.
Right away, the internet was a huge hit and people were on it all the time, so much that it became a problem for the hunting and the farming that are necessary for their way of life. And so what the Mrubo leaders did is nowadays in almost all of the villages, the internet is only on for several hours in the morning and several hours in the evening and then all day Sunday.
Oh my God, the internet caused them to stop farming.
Well, not just farming, but gathering.
And hunting.
Yeah.
Hey, you know, we're running real low on meat. You want to go out there and get some meat for us?
One elder, And remember, these are people that are pretty, I don't think they were undiscovered, you know, but they were pretty remote. One elder said, in the village, if you don't hunt, fish, and plant, you don't eat.
Right.
Internet access has been limited to 2 hours in the morning, 5 at night, but on Sunday, you can get the internet all day. Get that NFL package while you're at it.
All it took was 9 months.
The tribe says they are already dealing with the following after 9 months of having the internet. Group chats full of gossip. Addictive social networks. Abusive online strangers. Hours and hours of sports streaming. Violent video games, scams, misinformation, and minors watching pornography. Yep, they got the internet all right. Yep. It isn't all bad. The story goes on to say the internet does allow the tribe to chat with loved ones living far away. Yes, my cousin lives in the next jungle over. Access educational opportunities.
How to hunt more. How to gather more.
Meet near me.
They say that there have been cases where it has saved lives in emergency situations. That if somebody lived because they had access to the internet. Overall, there are mixed reviews. One leader said, I think the internet will bring us much more benefit than harm, at least for now. Another tribal leader said, when it arrived, everyone was happy talking about the internet. But now things have gotten worse. Young people have gotten lazy because of the internet. You know what they did in Norway?
No way.
Norway.
Norway?
Mm-hmm. They put in a policy that your phones did not work during school hours. Like, you could have them in your pocket, but they didn't work.
Oh, that's amazing.
And they reported that the difference was night and day. They did it for a school year and found out it's like, oh, it's almost like breaking a spell that people are under. But kids in Norway can't access the internet on their phones until school's out.
Isn't it interesting that impulse control is so bad that you just need to get rid of the entire infrastructure? Like, you can't just tell kids, because you know what, Joanne? I think probably when we were in high school, phones in schools was like the beginning of things.
I can't believe it. The first time I went,
ours didn't have internet.
And I was on school grounds maybe 12 years ago. And I saw these kids in class. They all got their phone out. I'm like, you know, we weren't allowed to have a yo-yo. We weren't allowed to have a transistor radio. All of that stuff would have been
He sounds so old, doesn't he?
Transistor radio.
Yeah. You couldn't have a transistor radio at school.
Well, these phones are just like my day.
I remember looking at it and like, oh, this is not going to work out well. Because nobody was paying attention to the teacher. Everybody was on their phone. People were just texting each other back and forth. It was bedlam, I tell you.
Like Joanna said, there wasn't even internet but I remember taking a phone to school as like an emergency just
there's
in case.
There's been internet and really since 92. Since 92 there's
not
been
on
internet.
The phone. You had to pay extra for that.
Where's your brain at today? We were talking about phones in school right now. Where did you get off the sidetrack about thinking about internet from 1991?
Somebody's out there saying, no, definitely we had internet. You had internet by the time.
I just brought up on the phone.
On the phones.
What are you talking about?
It was extra if you wanted to connect to the internet. And then if you accidentally opened the internet on your phone, you'd like press the back button so many times. So you wouldn't get charged.
Also, I had it as an emergency just in case. And I remember thinking that if it went off accidentally, I was going to get like lined up and
they're
shot by firing squad.
My phone?
Yeah.
My mom
because your phone would have gone off at school?
Yeah. They made it seem
were
like.
Were they like, I don't want to hear any alerts or dings or anything?
Yeah, you couldn't have it on in school. And if that had happened, I was constantly afraid of like, getting like.
Man.
Shot.
When I go pick up my daughter. There are like 600 kids, and they're all looking on their phone, and they're all walking to wherever they're going to get their ride. And it's like they don't even look up in the intersection when they cross wrestler.
I see that all the time.
It's like, oh, no, I'm in my phone. You guys are supposed to stop. I'm a student. It's really incredible just how it's like everybody has got the same position. They're all looking at their phone, and that's just the way life is. I'm going to move to that Amazonian village. I'd like to hunt and gather all day. All right, we've got your late night roundup, which is something Joanna puts together for us early every morning. It's a recap of highlights and funniest moments from late night television. Here we go.
Gigantic invasive spiders are set for a New York City debut this summer. The Joro spider here is the nightmare fuel in question, and it can have a leg span up to 8 inches. Some are massive enough to catch and eat small birds, and experts expect them to populate the entire eastern seaboard eventually, which all sounds scary, but there's no need to panic. Everyone just needs to remain calm and set the East Coast on fire.
Instagram has started testing unskippable ads that users can't scroll past. Ooh. Here's how it works. You get to an unskippable ad, then you just open TikTok.
According to a new study, the second dirtiest city in America is Newark, New Jersey, and the first place, whichever city is downriver from Newark, New Jersey.
Artist interview, Zoom music discoveries, celebrating artists' birthdays, commemorating releases,
champion of all things rock,
dinner, even have information. Visit saltandhoneyep.com, where good food and good vibes collide. See you soon.
Live from the KLAQ studios, the Buzz Adams Morning Show. Courtesy of Glasheen, Vias, and Enderman personal injury lawyers.
At gvilaw.com.
We gonna level it up!
Yeah. Yeah, we're gonna level it up. I've got random facts on the way for you this morning. We're gonna find out about the Interrobang. I'm just going to let that...
I thought we didn't have pornography in Texas anymore.
I'm just going to let that hang there in the air for a second. The Interrobang. You will find out what that is in just a moment.
I know what that is.
Really? What is it? You're making a joke. You don't know what...
I mean, I can Google Interrobang, and I'm sure...
you could.
I'd find some stuff.
Hey, Father's Day is a week from Sunday, and we've got a contest that's coming together kind of last minute, but there's somebody out there that this is going to suit to a T. So we've got any lab test now that can do, if it's a lab test that exists, they can do it. So we wanted to do for Father's Day, if there's anybody out there who's just not sure and has always wanted to know, tell us your story. Include why you should be selected for this unique opportunity. And the winner and their alleged father or alleged child have to be available for a paternity test on Monday, June the 10th at any lab test now. But if there's anybody who has, I don't want to get anybody, whether you're bringing your baby in to get tested or anything like this. I'm not Maury. I have some standards. But anybody, both parent and child have to be 18 or older to participate. Contestants must be 18 years or older. Pregnant mothers, sorry, not eligible to participate. The paternity test is a simple mouth swab.
Oh.
So they don't have to take bone marrow or anything. Test must be completed by this Monday. The paternity test is a $500 value, and it is courtesy of any lab test now. So if you want to find out in time for Father's Day, if you are the real father, submit your story. And include why we should pick you. Download the KLAQ mobile app if you don't have it already. Submit your nomination via the chat button. We could also, I'm going to say, the app chat, if you want to put a story in there, Joanna will keep an eye out for any of those. Include a contact number if you do that. You can email me. I don't get that many emails. I get a lot of emails. I just don't get a lot of emails that are actual emails. You know what I'm saying, right? It's usually either the audio from the neckline or junk from corporate.
Yeah.
That's all I get. But if you want to send me an email, let me know a little bit about your story. Why do you want to get a paternity test for Father's Day? Maybe you're the child, you want to get it done. Maybe you're the dad and you want to get it done. We did this a few years ago. It was a beautiful, beautiful moment.
Oh. So you've done something similar?
Yes. I don't know if we could have the same luck that we did the last time, because it was a guy probably, you know, in his late 40s, and his son was in his early 20s. And I guess when they, okay, so here's how I remember the story. When he broke up with the boy's mother, she said some, you know, hurtful things about the son not really being his, and he wanted to find out. And this was kind of before 23andMe.
Oh,
like you really only got those cheek swabs as part of a legal obligation.
Daytime television talk show.
Yeah, or daytime television talk show. But they can do it now. Any lab test now at 7933 North Mesa. That's across from Sam's on the west side. And we will reveal the outcome of the test the Friday before Father's Day. Don't forget, Father's Day is the 16th, a week from this Sunday.
And now it's time for... 1, 2, 3.
Random facts.
All right, you know the rules here. These are all random. There's no reason for any of these facts other than we like to learn stuff from time to time. And we do a thorough job of fact checking. Random fact number one. Betty Boop was originally a talking French poodle when she debuted in 1930.
Oh, my.
She didn't become a person until 1932.
Boop, 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 boop.
Random fact number two. The largest living thing in the world is a mushroom in Oregon. That's 2.4 miles long.
Oh, my God.
I wonder if it's above ground or underground. Like, would you even know if you were walking on it? Humongous fungus. And it's all about mushrooms, but I wish they... Yeah, so apparently any place the mushrooms are poking out in this 2 mile radius is part of the same mushroom.
It's part of one mushroom?
It's part of one mushroom. They're just showing like different parts of it that poke up through trees or the ground or whatever.
Are they the kind of mushrooms you can trip out on?
I am sure it being in Oregon that plenty of people have tried to see what they're good for. But I didn't see that. All right, now this one is really, really interesting. Random fact number three.
Okay.
And I can go a little in depth on this. Have you ever heard of an interrobang?
Excuse me?
Yep. An interrobang is what I'm asking about.
Interrobang?
Yep.
No, I have not.
What does it sound like to you?
Like?
It sounds like sex where one person's asking the other person all kinds of questions.
Yeah.
We're interrobanging. In 1962, an ad executive named Martin Spector introduced a new punctuation mark called the interrobang, which combined a question mark with an exclamation mark.
All right.
It got put on some typewriting keyboards. It got popular enough that if you find some old typewriters, they'll have the interrobang. So it's a question mark with an exclamation mark.
Oh, my God. But, I interrobang a lot.
Yeah, but isn't that the same when you do, like, question mark, exclamation point, question mark, exclamation point?
Yeah.
It is depicted as one character.
Oh, okay. So it used to just be its own character.
Like I say, it never really caught on.
It didn't catch on.
In a big enough way. But I want you to know that in 1968... an interrobang key was available on some Remington typewriters. Supposedly, It has something to do with their value as antiques if they have the Intero bang on them.
Yeah, I would assume so, yeah.
In the 1970s, replacement Intero bang keycaps and typefaces were available for some Smith Corona typewriters. You know, you got nice. You got Remington and Smith Corona. That's about all the typewriter companies I know of.
Right.
The Intero bang was in vogue for much of the 1960s. The word appeared in some dictionaries, and the mark was used in some magazines and newspaper articles. Mm-hmm. So if you're ever going over an old Look magazine and they've got, it's not a typo, you're looking at an Intero bang.
I say we bring that back.
Give me
an emoji.
The guy who came up with this, Martin Spector, passed away a long time ago. Hmm. But his wife is still around. And here's Penny Spector talking about how her husband, Martin, invented the bizarre punctuation known as an Intero bang.
We were at dinner one night and he was lacking four pages. And all of a sudden, he thought of the Intero bang. So he called the art studio that we use and he said, "Is anybody there around who can draw?" And we...
You needed somebody to draw a question mark with... with an exclamation point through it?
I guess so.
Around who can draw. And we went over. We were there until about 3 o'clock in the morning. And he came up with a number of versions of the Intero bang.
There you go. The Intero bang. Not seen much. But if you got a keyboard with one on it, take it to Antiques Roadshow. Who knows?
Bring it back.
Or take it to Pawn Stars. And those are your random facts for today.
These are just some facts that I learned and was amazed. Everyone should try to learn something new each day.
Music news,
concert updates,
song and album factoids, and of course, nothing but El Paso's best rock.
.95.5 KLAQ and Judas Priest with Living After Midnight. And this month has been designated officially
Judas Priest!
It has been officially proclaimed and dedicated as Judas Priest. Extra Judas Priest featured song blocks throughout the month as we pay tribute to one of the originals and one of the hardest rocking metal bands of all time, Judas Priest. Judas Priest. And you can also win digital downloads of the new Judas Priest album called Invincible Shield. Be listening for that. We're really kicking it up with the Judas Priest for this month.
Judas Priest.
I got a few phone calls. I thought we'd go through these. And then Michael Rappaport, who hosts a podcast about reality television with his wife, Kibi. They're both going to join us. So it's going to be the Rappaports. It's called Rappaports Reality. And that's coming up here in just a few minutes.
Morning, Buzz. You mentioned any lab test now can do any kind of lab testing as long as it exists. Maybe us listeners could chimp in and get some gene testing on Nico to see... we can get that balding reversed or fixed, you know what I'm saying? Nail that in the head. Anyways, have a great day, guys. Bye.
They do any lab tests, but you don't need a lab test to tell you that Nico's losing his hair.
It's not that bad.
We're not gonna solve.
Yeah, there's no mystery here.
We're not gonna solve the mystery, or we're not gonna cure
look.
It.
Your DNA, your test is saying you're losing your hair.
Hey, good morning, guys. And I was hearing the news about the executive order on border policy, right?
Mm.
So I think the issue is that they can't come to an agreement on a policy, and they're creating this issue or making it even bigger. For what purpose? I mean, I don't know. But I mean, that neither side can agree to a policy is ridiculous. Like, they can't come up to a solution. Like the Trump era policies, I think they were bad because he had a lot of hateful comments to say after it versus just saying, hey, this is a policy to...
And that's a good point. You wonder, like, if Donald Trump hadn't come down that escalator just calling Mexicans rapists and murderers, do you think some of his policies might have been a little more realistic if they weren't just so coded in such racist rhetoric?
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, separating kids from their parents is, you know, that's pretty unforgivable under any tone, but...
Yeah, but once you take the personal animus out of policy...
Yeah, all of a sudden we can actually talk about policy, but when it's coded so heavily in racism and xenophobia, which I hate to break it to you, Trumpers, is exactly what it's been. That's part of what you like about him, if you would just admit it.
He hates people, too.
To stop this illegal immigration, right, or to control... You know, he went on and rant about, you know, oh, they're horrible people, yeah. They're the worst. So just a lot of hateful, like a lot of hateful sentiment behind it. And that's what made the Trump era policies bad. But yeah, we need to control the border. I think it's something necessary, but, you know, with good policies and good measures. But that's not going to happen, man. These guys are...
May not be. You may be right.
...are in it, too. Like the Bloods and the Crips. They're just never going to get along, which is bad for the country because we need to get along. All right, man.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah. I agree. And I think if you sit most people down in a room together and let them talk to each other, you'd find a lot more things that people agree on, even now, even in 2024. But yeah, I mean, my reaction to that, Trump's calling an entire group of people rapists and murderers, and that he was so wildly embraced, I felt like, well, I can't endorse or be in favor of any of his policies because it's just based on such blatant hatred and racism. Mm. Does that make any sense?
Yeah, absolutely. I think...
I mean, and Biden is doing some of the things that Trump was doing. You know, once it gets to 2,500 encounters a day, border's closed. No asylum claims.
But I think I think there are some people that would rather have this issue as a cudgel to beat their political opponents over as opposed to ever fixing it. It's much more convenient for them to have a boogeyman.
Hey, good morning show. Hey, Buzz. You got the bass back. But I was calling in about the policy.
What does that mean?
This must be the same caller yesterday who said that my voice sounded different since Friday. Yeah. And it's like... Yeah, he doesn't have that bass sound in his
that gravitas.
Yeah, I guess so. I think it's the same.
And I agree.
Hey, morning show. Hey, Buzz, you got the bass back.
Bass is back, baby.
But I was calling in about the policy, and I'm not talking about the policy. I think the policy we should be focused on is the attendance policy on Mr. Adimian. Hey, bro, where you been, bro? You know, we miss you too, homie. Stop calling in. Yeah, Alvaro. Well, if you're going to call in, at least bring some burritos or something for Joanna and Buzz could eat. Help for carrying the show, bro.
They carried the show.
All right, guys. Take it easy.
Joanna's back is really tired because I was out on Monday.
Her back is tired from carrying
the
show.
Did you know that I didn't come in on Monday? You know why? I couldn't find my keys.
Yeah, I knew that was going to happen.
And you know where I was looking for them? The yard, because I've been sleeping outside with my poor sick dog.
Joanna, did you bring up the pictures I sent you?
I did, yeah.
Hey, man, it's not cool to be going around taking people's pictures. Somebody might think I was passed out, like passed out.
You were.
Or something.
Next to your dog.
That wasn't
cute.
The only reason I was on the ground.
And you have not been... What the hell, Derek? What the hell, Derek?
Listen, we got to take a break.
Did you see that email, yeah, Joanna?
Yeah. I'm not going to read that one. Hey, the CEO of Netflix says the Tom Brady roast, quote, drove huge viewing and even more conversation. And they're saying that Netflix might be interested in doing even more roasts.
Well, I'll get somebody as big as Tom Brady.
You know, I keep seeing that thing come up. I could watch it anytime I want to, but I feel like, oh, it's, you know, at this point, it's a little late for that, don't you think?
Right.
But I got Duke to roast the morning show. Since it worked for Tom Brady, I think it'll work for us.
Good morning. Good morning. You're welcome. You know, I always start my morning with a show. That way I know that no matter what happens the rest of my day, it can't get any worse.
Ooh. Oh, that hurts.
This show is harder to get through than a Nickelback Christmas album. I mean, if this show was any worse, it would still be this show. My favorite place to listen to this show is my car. My favorite time is never. Seriously, though, thank you so much for having me. You all suck. Have a great rest of your morning.
Coming up after the Buzz Adams Morning Show, Glenn Garza and Daniel Polis.
For you, for offer subject to change, valid for qualified residential customers only. Restrictions apply.
Hey, it's Chuck, your host for Loudwire Nights. Tonight at 7, we will rock the borderland with the best rock ever made and the best rock being made. Special guests, birthday and anniversary celebrations, and every night at 10, a block of Metallica as we fulfill Mission Metallica. All the rock that matters, Loudwire Nights on 95.5 KLAQ.
Joanna has the Hollywood Cheese Make coming up for us in just a few minutes. We're going to be talking about another reality show, a new reality show. And we got some feedback from our conversation with Michael
Rapaport.
Yeah, and Kibi Rapaport, husband and wife team. Their podcast is called Rapaport Reality. Let's take a couple of these calls.
Yo, morning show. You got Michael Rapaport lauding the benefits of the reality shows. So my favorite reality shows would be Average Joe, because that was hilarious. The guy was.
That's the one where they tricked him, or
everybody was an actor except him.
Yeah.
Right?
Oh, no, I'm thinking Joe Millionaire.
No, that was Joe Schmo. What is Average Joe? Joanna, can you look that up?
Okay.
And by the way, this is Big Daddy Delicious. So by playing this, I'm informally lifting the ban on Big Daddy D. As long as you don't say the C word on the air again.
This is Average Joe's guy was a moron. Show. It's
Average Joe?
Yeah, it's not a reality series.
The guy was a moron, and everybody was fake but him.
That was the Joe Schmo.
Maybe he got the names wrong.
Yeah, I think he got the name. It was the Joe Schmo show.
The Joe Schmo.
Everybody
show.
Was fake but him. Yeah. That was a funny show. And also, I never missed a single episode of Flavor of Love, starring Flavor Flav. And I would laugh so hard every episode. It was just the idea that this very, very, very ugly man looked like a goblin, had a house full of basically whores competing with one another to be with him and act like he was the most greatest thing, and he would just so...
He's a goblin. Have you ever thought that Flavor Flav looks like a goblin?
Oh my God, what a coincidence. I also have a Flavor Flav story.
Yeah?
Yes.
Yeah?
He was just so ugly and goblinish. I laughed so hard. And also I count the Tom Green show on when he aired MTV. On MTV. Mm. That guy is underrated. He is a comedy genius, and I think he influenced a lot of talk shows and a lot of shows.
That could be true. Let me take a couple of guesses. Mm-hmm. I think Tom Green was an influence on the Jackass guys.
Yeah.
Especially putting Bam's parents in really uncomfortable, playing pranks on Bam's parents. That was a Tom Green thing. What else? It was kind of the Eric Andre show. I think was probably influenced a little by Tom Green.
All right, morning show. You have a good day. Bye bye.
All right, the ban is lifted.
Nice.
All right, Joanna, you have a Flavor Flav story.
I do.
Let me hear this.
Is it a personal story?
No, it's a story in entertainment news.
Oh, okay.
Oh wait, you have. Oh, will you do that story last?
Yes.
Oh, I thought you meant you had a story you wanted to share with.
Oh, like a personal story? No. But wow. Can you believe there was a time and place where women competed and the prize was Flavor Flav.
Flavor Flav. Right.
Flavor of Love, one of my favorite shows ever.
Was it?
Was that the one where one of the ladies
pooped on the stairs?
Pooped on the stairs.
That was one of the greatest episodes of television to watch when it came out.
Hey, maybe they'll really take me up on that and bring back the soup.
Yeah, seriously.
I wouldn't mind getting an EP on a show.
Oh, no, they're going to forget all about you. They're going to do it on their own. And then when they come out and be like, yeah, we came up with this idea on our own, you can play the audio back.
Wow. So based on Nico's factoid, that makes Michael Rappaport a nepotism baby? Didn't know that.
I looked this up. It was not his father. It was his stepfather.
Okay. Well,
who?
What if he thinks of him as his father, Buzz? Did I say bio dad? What, do you have to correct every little minuscule difference?
Well, hold on a second. I just want to say
it wasn't his dad.
He's not primarily his stepdad. I'm not sure he's a nepo baby because he was primarily a movie actor, movie and TV.
Okay, do you want to just read? Rappaport's stepfather, comic Mark Lonow, who owned the Improv with Bud Freeman, helped him get into the stand-up world.
He did that for 3 years. His big break in acting was on the TV series China Beach.
Of course he's a nepo baby. Yes, he had lots of help getting into the entertainment industry.
I'm asking for a very specific reason.
Okay.
So my daughter's 17. She's going to be a senior in high school. And
congratulations.
Yeah. She's going to be a senior next year. She's expressed some interest in getting a job. Her sister's got a job. And
she would be a nepo baby.
And no matter what.
No matter
like
what.
If I'm like, oh, I know the guy who owns yes. that. And but she really does not want to be perceived as having nepo
when
advantages.
You tell her,
she doesn't want to be associated with the name Buzz Adams.
No, Joanna, it's different than that. These are the conversations. So Buzz is telling her, hey, you know, I know this person and I know the owner of that place and I know this. I could get you a job anywhere. And she's like,
okay.
But that's typical parent stuff. You do that,
yeah,
whether it's,
sure.
you know, that's, oh, you want a job at the at the auto shop? Yeah, I know the guy. You know, if your father's established.
Yeah, but do you know them as Michael Witt or as Buzz Adams?
I know everybody is Buzz Adams now.
She's going to be.
Joanna,
she's going to be like, hello.
I think she's going to be perceived as a nepo baby no matter what.
If somebody grew up there.
What? No.
Yeah.
I don't think so.
You can't help that when you have a famous
I'm not famous
father.
Enough to be a nepo baby. That's impossible.
I don't think Buzz is that famous.
And I've told her, I've said, hey, listen, don't overestimate, you know, how much juice I have. Because if you go 30 miles outside of El Paso, zero. You know, I have.
Well, they're all El Paso jobs.
Also, if you go to Horizon, they love us over there. Shout out Horizon.
Horizon! I'll see you this weekend.
Oh, you're going to have fun.
Tell us where you're going to be.
You tell me. You have the liner.
I will tell you that Nico is going to be at Horizon Vista Market on Saturday. 3 to 5, and he's going to be.
Oh, that's where they love us.
Yeah.
At Horizon Vista Market?
Mm-hmm.
Is that a grocery store?
Mm-hmm.
It is, yeah.
Like regular grocery store, like a farmer's
like a
market
Vista.
Or something?
You've been to a Vista, right?
I'm not sure.
Yeah, probably you haven't.
Probably not.
Well, it's at 121 North Canazo, and we're introducing Troy Aikman's new beer, which is a real tongue twister, 8 Elite Light Lager. Made with 100% organic grains, no cheap fillers, with only 90 calories and 2.6 grams of carbs. 8 Elite is truly light beer made right. Nico's going to have some gear, some 8 Elite gear, some Troy Aikman beer gear, and also NFL gift cards to give away. So you want to win that? It's 3 to 5 this Saturday. Horizon Vista Market, 121 North Canazo, and Nico will be there.
Yep. Also, tonight, I've got trivia night. I'm going to be hosting trivia at the Silo Bar at the substation on the west side. Trivia starts at 7. It's going to be a great time. There's going to be $5 Guinness beer, lots of prizes. I've got prizes, gift certificates to Buffalo Wild Wings, gift certificates to the Silo Bar itself.
So I can help out with directions.
Yeah.
I know the Silo Bar well. It's in the substation.
Yep.
Corner of Sunset and Donovan. it's the place that's right next to the silo. Like an actual silo.
It looks like an actual silo.
Yeah. I don't know if it does any, you know, it might just be for looks. I don't know if they ever store grain
up there or water.
I'm not exactly sure.
It's the Hollywood cheese man. It's the Hollywood cheese man. Joanna, tell us more.
And here is Joanna Barba with today's Hollywood cheesemaker. Good morning, Joanna.
Good morning.
Don't forget, end with your Flavor Flav story.
I will, yes.
Okay.
It's almost time to check in with everyone's favorite blondies and their massive dragons. And Max is gearing up in the only way it knows how to, by increasing prices so that those dragons can have a nice, comfy life.
I don't even watch the dragon show.
You don't? I don't either.
Is it House of Dragons?
Yes.
Well, you pay for me and Lisa to watch HBO Max.
So you're paying for it either way.
Wait, did you also cancel your Paramount Plus?
Yes, I did.
God!
It's not Paramount Plus month.
It's not Paramount Plus month.
Dang it.
The streamer announced yesterday that prices for its ad-supported tiers will get a slight increase. The ad-free tier, which supports two streaming devices at a time, is increasing by $1 to $16.99 a month, or $169.99 a year. The ultimate ad-free, which allows up to four devices streaming at the same time, will also raise to $20.99 a month, or $209.99 a year. The good news is, if you don't mind ads, the basic Max with ads tier is still $9.99. Okay. This will likely be Max's best bet when it comes to convincing new subscribers to hop on board. The new prices will apply to new subscriptions, while existing monthly and yearly subscribers will be told 30 days before their plan needs renewal. This is only the latest streamer to get a price bump over the last year. Peacock just announced a $2 increase ahead of its Olympic coverage, and Hulu made a similar move last fall. Amazon Prime Video also introduced ads into its basic plan, while Netflix plans to increase prices again later this year. Yo, they got like one more price hike before I bust out that DVD player.
Right? Or do the thing I'm doing, one service a month.
Only one service a month. I'm going to have a family meeting with all the boys in my house and be like, we can only choose one. Who's staying?
Wait. Which streaming service is staying, or which nephew's staying?
Both. We're going to kick one off the island.
We're all voting.
Get those kids a paper route or something. Have them start contributing.
Oh, my nephews are starting a business. Anyone out there? They are cleaning yards for the summer.
Oh, yeah.
So if anybody needs anything, let me know. Paul Giamatti is set to star in a Hostel TV series.
That is so weird. What a weird combination.
Right?
The movie series Hostel beloved actor Paul Giamatti.
Now, it's based on the gory films directed by Eli Roth. Yes,
Nina? Are you saying Hostile or Hostel?
Hostel.
Like a youth hostel.
Did you ever see those Hostel movies from Eli Roth?
I did see one of the first ones.
Like when the kids in the village are using a severed head as a soccer ball?
I'm not sure if I saw that one. I might have seen the very first Hostel.
Out of all of that gore in it, the one that really got me is where they kind of like above your ankle, they slice it.
God, like your Achilles tendon?
Yes.
That's it. That's the one. Yes, that's the one.
That's the one that got me the most. Okay. I don't care about the eyeball gouging.
I mean, that is legitimately, when people use the term torture porn.
Gore porn,
that's the definition right there.
Because I see no value in it. I honestly don't see. I don't see it as a story.
I don't know. It's pretty tense when you're in there. You're like, oh my God. I don't know. It has like a visceral effect on you.
Yeah, right.
It doesn't progress the story.
You don't want to watch, but you kind of, in Hostel, it does.
Yeah. It makes you wonder, do I have any friends that would pay to go to Eastern Europe just to kill somebody? Yeah, I probably know a few people.
You start to think, like, who here would totally... Buzz Adams would totally pay for that.
No.
I bet you would. According to The Hollywood Reporter, the series serves as a modern adaptation, a reinvention of the blood-soaked horror franchise, as well as an elevated thriller. Roth is, of course, set to write the script and will also direct. Giamatti recently took the Golden Globe for Best Actor for his role as a boarding school teacher in The Holdovers, and he's currently filming Downton Abbey 3. And if you're interested...
What? Paul Giamatti's going to be on Downton Abbey 3?
Yeah, I guess so. If you're interested, Hostel and its sequels are streaming now on Stars and Hulu.
Like, you know, when I worked in the ER, the EMC is a level one trauma center. We'd have accidents where somebody would have their arm out of the window driving, and it rolled, and it would cut their arm off. Yep. And they came in and they handed me the arm and took the body.
They're like, here, hold this.
They're like, here, this one, this is whatever you do, do with it.
You know. Oh my God.
Should I be worried about the guy? No, he's armless.
No, he could really use a hand. Okay. God, God.
Hold on, I gotta write that down.
But you know what I mean? Like, when you see that in real life,
you don't want to go to the movies and see that.
Yeah.
Exactly. Most of us will never see that. I think maybe a horror movie is a way that we
could possibly relate to it. Or,
yeah. I mean, there's something in the human psyche that a lot of people dig those kind of movies, man.
Alec and Hilario Baldwin are inviting viewers into their chaotic home for a reality series airing on TLC. The husband and wife duo announced the show with the working title The Baldwins in a video posted to Instagram in which their 7 children run around the house screaming.
Hi, I'm Hilario Baldwin.
And I'm Alec Baldwin.
And we have an announcement to make.
We're inviting you into our home to experience the ups and downs, the good, the bad, the wild, and the crazy. Home is the place we love to be most.
You say we are the Baldwins.
No, we are the Baldwins. We all got to say.
1, 2, 3. We are the Baldwins.
Oh, my God.
We're coming to TLC.
Shooting begins next week.
That is the joke everyone is having. The show will air sometime next year.
Way to be original.
And fine.
Is it going to like have courtroom coverage when Alec Baldwin goes on trial for that?
God, I don't know.
Can I tell you something, though? I do enjoy hearing like the laughter of children and the fact that Alec Baldwin seems like he's in a happy relationship with
all his kids. He's got great support from his family.
Yeah, it does. You know,
just God forbid any of them acts like a rude, thoughtless little pig.
But word on if the rude, thoughtless little pig will also appear.
For as lonely as you are, you wouldn't want to have like 8 different little kids all around you the time.
That sounds terrible.
No. One.
Do you want that, Nico?
I wouldn't mind a family.
Like 8 little kids just get it.
I'm sure it makes for a very entertaining Yeah, I'm sure it's entertaining.
It's a lot of stress. It's when you start to look old. As soon as you have a kid, you age 10 years in that first year of your kid's life, I swear to God. And if you have a second kid, it does it all over again.
Finally.
I don't know. Finishing a tall boy in my backyard watching Golden Girls seems like a worse alternative than that.
All right. Finally, it looks like Red Lobster has at least one savior in the form of Flava Flav, the hip-hop legend who is either a fan of Red Lobster or just someone doing his part to save the chain restaurant from bankruptcy, posted to X Monday a picture of him standing in front of a glorious seafood spread, which was apparently everything on the Red Lobster menu. He captioned it saying, quote, "Ya boy meant it when I said I was going to do anything and everything to help Red Lobster and save the Cheddar Bay biscuits. Ordered the whole menu." Red Lobster, of course, if you'll remember, filed for Chapter 11 in Florida last month. Flav is apparently in talks to meet with Red Lobster for a potential collaboration. Dozens of restaurant locations have closed, but Red Lobster says that they will still have 600 locations open while they try to sell the company.
He ordered one of
everything
menu item?
Of the menu, yes.
He got the ultimate feast.
The ultimate seafood feast.
He got the Admiral's feast.
The underwater world of Jacques Cousteau is what he got.
He got the Walt's favorite surf and turf.
Yes.
All of it.
All of it.
Okay. Mm. I don't think that's going to save him from bankruptcy, even if you had 100 Flavor Flaves out there.
With your entertainment news, I'm Joanna Bobo.
At Red Lobster, we no longer have all-you-can-eat shrimp because you already all-you-can-eat us right out of business. That's right. Red Lobster is closing our doors for good. But until that happens, stop in. Mondays are now our $19.99 all-you-can-eat lemon wedge-a-palooza. Tuesday, shell out $8.99 for our all-you-can-carry chairs that smell like butter farts. Then there's the $7.99 whatever Wednesday, where you can take whatever vintage tartar sauce is left in the back of our fridge. And Thursday is our all-you-can-grab copper wiring promotion. If you want to stock up on a few hundred feet of copper wire without breaking the bank, come to Red Lobster. Look for our bright red sign that says, "For lease." Plus, everyone that orders gets a free salt shaker. The bankrupt Red Lobster. When you're here, your family is gonna starve.
right, we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, Nico Ajimian with news headlines coming up.
Yep, FDA just voted against approving MDMA for treating PTSD. I'll have the details next in news.
What's so funny?
That's easy. That would be listening to Bud Adams and the Morning Crew.
Okay, I think we've heard enough of this.
Friends, hurry! Every bite's a big deal.
Welcome to Jack in the Box.
Limited time only. Price and participation may vary.
The Buzz Adams Morning Show, Monday through Friday, 5 to 10. KLEQ and KLEQ HD1, El Paso, a Town Square media station.
What's the buzz? Tell me what's happening. What's the buzz? Tell me what's happening. What's the buzz? Tell me what's happening. What's the buzz? Tell me what's happening.
Give out our phone numbers. Make sure everybody has those handy. If you want to leave a message, very popular option is the neckline. You can call the neckline 24 hours a day and leave a message. Leave a message during the show and we'll get it. 844-805-NECK is the number for the neckline. I'll repeat that. It's 844-805-6325. If you got a live call for us, if you want to talk to us live, by all means, call the studio line while we're here from 6 to 10 a.m. And the studio line number is 915-910-4995. That's 910-4995. I've got some calls that were topical to some of the stuff that we've been talking about. A few of the things that came out in Joanna's report. We had actor Michael Rappaport and his wife earlier. A lot of people had some comments about that. I just wanted to tell Joanna, I'm not sure if this story is going to be in the news, but they're covering the Hunter Biden trial.
Are you going to say this on air?
Yeah. So it's the same deal with the Trump trial where there's no pictures. It's just courtroom artists.
Artist sketchings.
So it's a picture of a courtroom and on a TV or a monitor.
So remember that Hunter Biden was videotaped himself
naked,
smoking a cigarette and I think maybe meth at one time.
Yeah, right. So
these are the videos that they're showing.
These are
the videos they're showing in court to the jury.
So we're seeing an artist drawing of Hunter Biden's naked smoking video. And
like it's an image of the courtroom. And you see Hunter Biden in his suit, but then next to him is like a TV screen.
Nice.
And it's him naked holding a cigarette like this.
That's great.
I'm surprised they're able to do it. I would have thought they would run out of orange crayons by the end of the Trump deal.
I laugh so hard in the break right now.
Just that
from
image.
That, yeah.
Got a number of calls here. So let me just get through some of these. Nico has the news coming up.
Hey, good morning, guys. It's Five Points Guy.
Hey, Five. Hey,
I was looking forward to that Rappaport interview. It was awesome. Telling my wife yesterday that, you know, she's a huge Bravo fan. I guess I am too, since, you know, support whatever she watches. But, I love Michael Rappaport. He's hilarious. And we were watching that new show on Amazon Prime called Fallout, right? Out of nowhere, Rappaport comes out as one of the Titans, and he has a small scene. I couldn't stop laughing because I had literally just told my wife about the interview of him. But yeah, check out Fallout. It is actually really, really good. I think Padilla was the one that recommended that show, and it's better than The Last of Us. But yeah, no, it is a really good show. I enjoyed it. Have a good one, guys.
Yeah, he is in Fallout. Yeah. So I never play video games, but I watch TV shows sometimes based on video games, and I forget that they're based on video games. I guess there's a group of people that basically have Iron Man suits, kinda, and he's one of them.
The power suits, yeah.
Did you ever play Fallout?
No. I just saw the show.
Your hair sure has.
Sorry, Nico.
Boo!
We may have to issue a correction and retraction. So, Big Daddy Delicious called in earlier and said that he loved a reality show called Average Joe, and we thought he was talking about Joe Schmo. Can you look up? Was there? Well, here's another call. There might be a show called Average Joe's.
Hey, Buzz. Hey, Nico.
My favorite show, and correct me if I'm wrong, was Average Joe's, and that's the one that came out on Spike, and it, you had these losers that they either never played sports or didn't play anything past like Pop Warner or recreational sports, and they'd go out there and talk smack to these legends of the game. And it was just, I love watching the faces on these athletes, like, I'll take out Lawrence Taylor, or, you know, or Mike Tyson, what have you, you know.
Yeah, I remember this somebody show. Who was like, you know, I was all state in high school, so I'm going to go up against whoever, you know.
It's what anybody who says, who's like, was an athlete in high school or college, and today they watch, you know, sports, and they're like, oh, I would beat LeBron. I was so much better than LeBron in high school. You know what?
In a game of 21, if I get my hands on the ball, I could score at least points against LeBron, all right?
You're not joking about this, right? I've heard you say that before.
They really need to bring that back in 2024, calm some of these armchair quarterbacks now with the advent of, you know, the internet bigger now and all that fantasy football and stuff. Anyways, have a great day, guys. Love y'all. Bye-bye.
All right. I guess maybe Big Daddy D was talking about that show.
Yeah, that'd be a good idea.
Sounded, he was describing what sounded a lot more like Joe Schmo, where everybody was actors except for the main guy.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, no, your daughter's not a Nepo baby. If she wasn't, by that definition, then Nico would be a Nepo baby. I mean, you're technically, you know what I mean, right? I'm not going to say it.
I don't know.
His daddy. But either way, he does come from an extensive ranching background with horses and escargot and a mansion on Montana. I mean,
escargot and a horse named Rose Hips and a mansion on Montana.
There's no mansion. What are you talking about?
You said there was a mansion.
I said my great grandmother, who had her house since the 20s, had a house that was on Montana. It was a small little house where all the law offices are.
Yeah, I've seen those. None of those are small.
Yes, they are.
Houses.
Some of them are small.
Those are mansions. Those are Victorian.
No, they are not.
Mansions.
He's a Nepo baby. Also, does Nico have to get you something on Father's Day? I would. I bet.
I'm not getting you anything on Father's Day.
Now, the dynamic is weird. It's like the dynamic between me and Brad. Like, Brad's older than I am.
He is?
Much older than
I am. No, you guys look the same age.
Not that older, though. You mean something like he's...
I don't think of you as somebody, as being somebody young enough to be my son.
I think of you as like a son.
Really?
Yes.
How does that make sense?
That you are so immature and ignorant sometimes, I feel like I have to baby you and take
both
care
of you are my children. I expect a Father's Day gift from both of you. Yeah. I am your daddy.
I believe that would have been Mother's Day, and I'm sorry you have another year to go.
I am your daddy.
I keep saying that, Joanna.
All right,
we got a few messages about the Nepo baby thing. Irene says, nepotism doesn't have anything to do with being famous.
It's
anyone
rich.
Obtaining employment through familial connections can be considered a Nepo baby.
That's a good point. Yeah.
Hunter Biden, definitely a Nepo
baby.
And someone else
all
says,
the Trump kids. I mean, it's kind of, if your parents are rich enough,
not even,
it's hard to avoid being in
that. No, this person's saying
it doesn't have to be that you're rich or famous. It's just that you already have these connections.
Like, you could be a poor person. If you got your son a job at the auto shop, that would be a Nepo baby.
I don't know why you got to call that out as being a profession for the poor.
You know what? I did do that. No, I did not mean that at all. I just was trying to think of
exactly what it sounded like.
He probably meant like not as wealthy.
Yeah, right. You were trying to say rich people are the only people. I was just trying to say like anybody. Average. Thank you, Joanna.
Also, I have come to the conclusion of all this Average Joe drama.
Yeah.
Average Joe was a different reality show that had some Average Joes competing to win the heart of a beauty queen. The one everyone's talking about where it was...
The sports one?
The sports one was called Pros versus Joes.
Pros versus Joes.
Was on Spike TV.
Yep.
God, now we're getting to the point where certain reality shows seem like ancient television history.
Now, where does Joe Millionaire fall into all of that?
That was one of the first.
Mm. That was one of the first.
Good morning, Mo Show. Hey, Buzz. Hey, Nico. Y'all are talking about the gory stuff and the ER stuff. Nico, dead serious question, dude. Mm. In all your years in the ER or being a paramedic, EMS, what have you? Have you ever encountered a guy with a broken wiener?
Oh, my God, dude.
That just came out of left field, didn't it?
It happened. It's happened before, and it still happens. A broken wiener. Have you ever encountered that? Have a great day, guys. Love y'all. Bye-bye.
Nico, have you ever encountered, and I'm going to include in your personal life as well as your occupation, have you ever encountered a guy with a broken wiener?
Yes, actually. So multiple and different types of things that have happened. All right, so if we want to talk about just about the broken wiener.
Yeah, how does it normally happen? I figured, like, wow, you want to hear?
It normally happens from sex.
You're having sex and you're vigorously, and then somehow it doesn't align and it bends.
It bends.
Yeah, right.
Right.
Like, so you're just going in, you're going at it so hard that you hit something that doesn't give, and that's where the penis fracture comes.
So the tissue of the wiener is actually called it's not even a bone.
I know there's not a bone in there.
Right. It's actually sponge-like material. It's actually called the corpus spongiosum and the corpus cavernosum. and it fills with the blood. Anyway,
I bet this guy was not expecting this in-depth of an answer.
So when the wiener breaks, a lot of times blood will backflow into the testicles.
Good Lord.
And I have seen...
Do you have to drain that?
It drains eventually on its own back into you, but
the blood disperses.
I swear to God, guys, not even a lie. The size of a volleyball. The testicles kind of lose their shape, and the whole thing just turns purple, and the size of a volleyball.
Okay, a volleyball is this.
I've seen it.
No,
gigantic.
I'm making the size of a volleyball is bigger than a cantaloupe.
Like a cantaloupe.
Okay, I'll say cantaloupe. Cantaloupe. Yeah, I'll say cantaloupe. And then the other
And what is it that's swollen?
What do you mean swollen? No, it's the backflow of blood into the testicles.
Oh, so it's the testicle.
It's the testes.
Both testes are the size of one cantaloupe?
About one cantaloupe.
Okay. Or does it just go into one?
No, it loses shape and you just see like this one. And then the other thing is a phimosis where the...
Now, as soon as that happens and your blood finally goes to where it needs to go, how soon after can you continue relations?
Resume.
First of all, great question, Joanna. Second of all, only for the person who had it.
How long would a guy have to wait?
Why would you be interested in that?
I just want to know. We're all learning something today.
I actually don't know that question. The answer to that
question.
Yeah, look it up for yourself.
Joanna knows a guy who's been using that excuse for 6 months.
The other really weird one is for uncircumcised guys, and the foreskin can actually get caught around the wiener, and it's called phimosis. And
what?
Yeah, and it actually acts like a rubber band around it, and so it will cut off circulation to the tip, top.
This is for the foreskin.
The foreskin gets retracted, and it will actually close around the member and almost strangulate it. And you have to do what's called a dorsal slit. You have to get a scalpel and go through the top and cut it.
All right. Just be aware, if you call in with any medical questions, this is what you're going to get. Like a very detailed answer. Yes, you have seen broken wieners.
Many.
Real quick, let me do the El Paso weather. It's brought to you by Wet and Wild. Let's check the forecast for today. We got heat advisories, folks, and we're expecting it to get super, super hot. 104 today and partly cloudy. We don't have any rain that's going to cool us off or anything. No wind, though. Wind's going to be very light. So if you want to do some outdoor activity, just be aware of the extreme heat. Tomorrow, partly cloudy, 106. And we do see a chance of rain on Thursday, but not until the afternoon around 1, 2 o'clock. Let's put it at a 15 to 20% chance of rain on Thursday afternoon and evening. On Friday, still up in those triple digits. 104 is going to be the high on Friday. Partly cloudy, and again, we're going to see somewhere between a 20 and 30% chance of rain Friday afternoon, Friday evening. Not as much so on Saturday and Sunday. It's going to stay warm. With temperatures of 102 on Saturday and 98 on Sunday. This weather update brought to you by Wet n Wild. Get your season pass. Your season pass is good any day and every day. including for the Neon Paint Party on the 29th and the July 4th Fireworks Spectacular. Save on tickets and buy in advance now at wetwild.com. That's wetwild.com. Not joking about that heat advisory. A lot of places around this area through the Southwest are under a heat advisory. Right?
And now your Texas forecast from the Weather Channel. Look for a 90% chance of hee-haw, hot, yip, yip, yoo-hoo in the mid-morning. A yip, 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 hotty, hot, 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 ooh, hot, hot up there, yip, yip advisory is in effect throughout the day. Into the evening, look for a high chance of stepping outside and saying, hoo, doggy, hoo, yip, hoo, hoo, hot, 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 ooh, it's hot out here, ooh, ooh. So be on the lookout for that. Throughout the week, there will be scattered... So please be on high alert. This has been your Texas forecast from the Weather Channel.
Find out what's going on. Quirky facts about our region. Urgent things you need to know impacting your drive. And of course, nothing but El Paso's best rock. Oh, with double...
With a Husky 200 tool set for every kind of dad. Find the perfect gift at the Home Depot. How doers get more done.
Broadcasting in El Paso to El Paso. The Buzz Adams Morning Show on 95.5 KLAQ.
Morning is the news.
Woo!
And all of it is good.
Yeah!
And the weather's good.
Yay!
The fun is about to begin.
Time to get to our top stories of the day with news. Here's Nico and Jimmy. Good morning, Nico.
Good morning, Buzz. Good morning, Joanna. With several mayors of cities near the border in attendance, President Joe Biden took action on immigration yesterday. Biden signed an executive order that will temporarily shut down asylum requests when the average number of daily border crossing goes over 2,500, meaning that a shutdown would be required immediately since that threshold has already been met. The shutdown will last until the number of encounters drops to 1,500 per day. Here he is while announcing his new executive order tightening the immigration policy. He took a swipe at Republicans in Congress for not doing something before.
I've come here today to do what the Republicans in Congress refuse to do. Take the necessary steps to secure our border.
Well, he called out Republicans in Congress for not having dealt with the issues at the border. Well, Republican backlash against the order was strong, with House Speaker Mike Johnson saying the executive order didn't go far enough and labeled it an election year stunt. Here is Mike Johnson.
He can close the border down entirely. He's not going to do that. He has no interest in doing that. They want it wide open. So this weak measure here, don't be fooled.
Can I just say, if it is a weak measure, it's because it's going to get challenged by the courts. The ACLU said they're going to challenge this policy the same way they challenged it when Trump was president. The reason there was a bipartisan Senate bill was so that it would be encoded in law.
Right.
Otherwise, things just get bogged down in the courts. This went before the Republicans in Senate, and they, at the behest of Donald Trump, did not want to sign off on this bill that was co-authored by Jim Lankford, one of the most conservative senators in Washington. He's from Oklahoma. And they didn't want to do that because it looked like it'd be giving Biden a win. But, yeah, you're going to see any of these moves. Suits are going to be brought by ACLU and other advocacy groups. So the idea of getting it legislated would have circumvented that, but the Republicans weren't willing to play. That is
because they think it would help their election chances.
They think that it would help Biden's election chances, although there are plenty of Democrats who are not happy with Biden saying that he's just doing Trump light.
No, I'm saying that the Republicans didn't want to pass on the bill because
it would make the Democrats look good. It would be an accomplishment.
Well, a spokesperson for former President Donald Trump's campaign said that an exception in the order for unaccompanied children would give a green light to child traffickers and sex traffickers. Immigration advocates on the other side weren't happy with the order either. And the Biden administration expects to fight some court challenges against this new order. Here is Democratic Representative Ninette Barragan of California, who is one of the advocates on the left of Joe Biden, not very happy.
It's not a time for us to turn to Trump-era policies. It's not time to go and use the tools that Trump used.
All right. Let's get into some local news. Temperatures will continue to linger around the 100-degree mark, but today will be especially hot. Today we are going to have the first true heat wave of the summer, and it's expected to get to 107 degrees, according to the National Weather Service. The scorching temperatures will persist for more than 24 hours, prompting heat advisories in El Paso, Hudspeth, and Doña Ana counties from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. today and tomorrow. While we hit our first 100-degree mark in May, temperatures will reach beyond the triple-digit marks for much longer. The chances that the temperatures will reach between 104 and 107 for the rest of the week are good. High pressure currently over northern Mexico will migrate to the El Paso area in the next few days, triggering the hotter weather.
Wow, now even the weather's migrating from Mexico?
And speaking of which, the El Paso City Health Services has already opened up cooling centers. That's right, cooling centers around all of El Paso, thanks to the Office of Emergency Management. These cooling centers will allow you to go inside, get water, provide air conditioning, and keep you cool throughout the hot day. It is a joint partnership between Parks and Recreation, the Office of Emergency Management, public libraries, and our Extreme Weather Task Force, which apparently El Paso has. The following free cooling centers are available from 9 a.m. to 8 p.m. The Galatzan Recreation Center on 700 East 7th Street, the Marty Robbins Recreation Center on 11620 Vista del Sol, the Valle Bajo Community Center at 7380 Alameda, Nations Tobin Sports Center at 8831 Railroad, and Chalillo Acosta Sports Center at 4321 Delta. You can also visit any of the city public libraries if you are extremely hot, and they will be air-conditioned. Don't forget, keep your pets that are normally outside, try and keep them inside or provide them with plenty of shade and plenty of fresh water. And don't take them for walks during peak heat hours.
No?
No.
Why? Because it's too hot for their little paws?
Yes.
Oh,
thank you for answering.
Is that the reason?
Your own question.
What if I get them little individual doggy shoes?
I don't think it's just that either. I don't think anybody, normal human beings, shouldn't be out walking at the peak heat hours at 107 degree weather.
If I can stand it, they can stand it.
I don't think you can stand it.
Okay.
Okay, so here's an interesting update. You know that new, what would you call it? Amphitheater that they're putting in the Northeast.
The location where Cohen Stadium is.
Right. Well, El Paso City Council has posted an agenda item concerning the sale of 17 acres in Northeast El Paso to Notes Live, Inc. Yep. That's for the construction of the new Sunset Amphitheater. So they're basically postponing anything. The decision was made to allow for a parking and traffic study, which is meant to help both the city and Notes Live understand the project's boundaries, but it will probably push everything a little bit back.
Okay, so I've written some articles about this. If you want to go back a couple of weeks, also Adrian Broaddus has talked about it, Steve Kaplowitz. So you've got different city entities and UTEP who are all planning on venues that are going to bring in A-list concerts. So UTEP wants to do a $99 million remodel of the Sun Bowl, which they say is going to bring in, you know, stadium concerts that we normally wouldn't get. They want the taxpayers, the El Paso County taxpayers, to foot part of the bill. But the county commissioners have spoken out, and a lot of them do not see it making the bill, saying that there's plenty of infrastructure that the voters are counting on before that. Meantime, the county commissioners say they are looking at a multi-million-dollar rehaul of the
Coliseum.
Of the county Coliseum.
Those come from bond issues, I think. Those are bond or quality of life
bonds.
Right,
right.
This,
Joanna, what was the condition of the Coliseum when you went to the last thing you went to there?
It's not bad.
Yeah.
It's the same.
It's been the same for
30 years.
Yeah.
It's been longer than that, I'm sure. But on the city council, they're still talking about doing that indoor-outdoor amphitheater combination.
Which one?
They want it downtown. You know, this is the downtown.
I'm not even giving credence to that. But
nobody believes that's going to happen.
So this one, the Sunset Amphitheater in the Northeast, is actually going to be part of something that's called the Cohen Entertainment District. Mm. We're going to have the 12,000-seat amphitheater, and that's expected to generate $6 billion in economic impact over 20 years. So that's good.
If any of these projects get done in a timely fashion and come in under or even just a little bit over budget, I'll even give you a little bit over budget. In the next 10 years, it'll be a minor miracle that any of this stuff actually gets done.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, back into some national news. No one is above the law. That's how the prosecution began its opening statements in the federal gun trial of Hunter Biden yesterday. Biden is accused of buying guns while using drugs, leading prosecutor Derek Hines to say addiction may not be a choice, but lying to buy a gun is. Biden's defense team said in its opening argument that to a drug user, there's a difference on a form between the question, are you a drug user, and have you been a drug user? Testimony was given about text messages seized with a search warrant that seemed to show Biden arranging drug deals during the time the gun was purchased, as well as bank records showing cash withdrawals. Biden is charged with making false statements on a federal gun form about his drug use. He faces up to 25 years in prison and $750,000 in fines if convicted. Now, let me ask you this. How many people in the United States who smoke marijuana do you think have signed that gun form?
I can't put a number on it.
Probably lots.
Oh, plenty.
Right.
Plenty of people believe in their right to arm themselves under the Second Amendment of the Constitution, who also believe that marijuana is not really a drug, so it shouldn't count.
Right. Exactly.
But and he was smoking crack and meth and stuff.
Yeah, but it wouldn't matter because they're both categorized as drugs. So if you signed a gun form saying you are not a drug user, but you still smoke marijuana or consume marijuana, you just lied, and you would be charged with the exact same thing that he's being charged with.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. 25 years in prison for that, huh?
Right.
Also, I think there's something working its way through the Supreme Court right now that would do away with that, but this would not apply to the other stuff that Hunter was doing. Yeah, you know, crack, for instance, is different from marijuana.
I don't think under the gun law is that gun law is the same for all of them. So there is no there is no relative drugism or drug relativism. All right,
they ask that question for a reason, to make sure that people that are using hard drugs, maybe they didn't have marijuana in mind when they came up with it. They should ask about alcohol. Do you get drunk a lot and like play with your gun? Because that's really dangerous. You shouldn't do that. Let's get realistic about it. If they really wanted to crack down on stuff that's dangerous to do, it's drinking and having access to a gun that leads to way more negative outcomes.
Yeah, I don't think they differentiated. Federal approval of MDMA to treat PTSD is going to have to wait for a while. A panel of the Food and Drug Administration voted 9-2 to not allow the use of the drug commonly known as ecstasy as a treatment for post-traumatic stress disorder. The panel questioned gaps in research that's been done so far and how the studies were designed. But their vote doesn't mean it won't happen. The FDA isn't required to follow the panel's recommendation and will decide by August 11th if they'll allow a trial of ecstasy.
I'll sign up for that. I hear it's a rule.
I'm sure you would.
I've heard good things. Is that like a drug that now is dangerous because people are mixing other crap in with it? MDMA. Like if you got pure from the laboratory MMA, the guy who invented it.
MMA, some mixed martial arts.
MDMA.
Straight from Dana White's house.
MDMA. Like the guy who invented it said, oh, it was perfectly safe when I synthesized it in a lab the first time.
This is, you were saying tangentially to the story, because that's not related to the story at all, right?
No. I just saw they interviewed, hey, here's the guy who invented maybe ecstasy. Is it the same thing?
Well, MDMA, pure MDMA would be what Molly, I guess we would say Molly is. But ecstasy is generally MDMA that is mixed with another drug keep it going. I think you're right in the sense that there's not like a overt large amount of toxic amounts for MDMA to kill you, but I do know
after it's exchanged hands a number of times.
No, that's not the point. It can leave you incredibly depressed. So that is one of the worst side effects. So I think suicide.
I always heard it made you really happy.
The side effects afterwards are depression.
Okay. All right, I'll pass.
Congressional leaders from both parties have invited Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu to... Yes.
And then we got to take a break.
Okay.
They have found in clinical studies that mindfulness... Do you know what the practice of mindfulness is?
Yeah. Do you?
Yes. Meditation.
Being aware of your...
Being aware. Taking a moment to self-reflect... But they say that in their clinical studies, like 10% of people who practice mindfulness, it actually has the reverse outcome for them. It spirals them into depression.
What?
Now I'm not making it up, man. I read it in a very prestigious publication.
What, BuzzFeed News?
I can't remember now, but if you want to research it, it's true. They said mindfulness, yeah, for most people, it's either harmless or helpful. But in a small minority of people, mindfulness is connected with a negative outcome.
Huh. Who'd have thunk?
Who'd have thunk it, huh? All right. Well, we'll come back and find out about Netanyahu in a minute, okay?
All right.
Let's get this break in. If you didn't stay up watching TV, Joanna has a recap for us every morning. It's our late night roundup, and here we go.
Gigantic invasive spiders are set for a New York City debut this summer. The Joro spider here is the nightmare fuel in question, and it can have a leg span up to 8 inches. Some are massive enough to catch and eat small birds, and experts expect them to populate the entire eastern seaboard eventually, which all sounds scary, but there's no need to panic. Everyone just needs to remain calm and set the East Coast on fire.
Instagram has started testing unskippable ads that users can't scroll past. Here's how it works. You get to an unskippable ad, then you just open TikTok.
According to a new study, the second dirtiest city in America is Newark, New Jersey, and the first place, whichever city is downriver from Newark, New Jersey.
Hey, it's Double G. Coming up after the Buzz Adams Morning Show.
On us, require terms and restrictions apply. Visit att.com/appreciation for details.
Live from the KLAQ studios, the Buzz Adams Morning Show. Courtesy of Glasheen, Vias, and Enderman personal injury lawyers.
At gvilaw.com.
Who's your daddy? Who's your baby? Who's your buddy? Who's your
I have something
man?
Important to say about Father's Day. First of all, Father's Day is sooner than you thought. It's a week from Sunday. Father's Day is the 16th, and we have a contest going on. Listen, the prize is a $500 value, but it's very specific. So if you want to win our paternity test, you need to submit your nomination now. You can do it on the KLAQ app. Submit your nomination via the chat button. So I guess that would go to the app chat, Joanna. You'd be responsible for checking those.
Yes.
Tell us your story. Why do you need a high-dollar paternity test? Also, this is just part of the... Every participant has to be 18 or older.
Including
The child. Right. And this could be coming from the... If you've got a question about your paternity... Send us your nomination. You can also email me, buzz@klaq.com. Tell us your story, why you should be selected for this unique Father's Day prize. Winner will be selected and notified, but the winner and the person they're testing with, the father, will find out the truth, must be available for the paternity test on Monday. This Monday, the winner And the father, or not the father, will meet at any lab test now. That's any lab test now. 7933 North Mesa. That's across the street from Sam's on the west side. Then on Friday, the Friday before Father's Day, we are going to review the results. The last time we did this, we had a guy, you know, 40s. His son was probably like around 20. And I guess when the dad broke up with the mom, she had said some cruel things that, you know, like, it's not, yeah, right? So they were both really hoping that he was the father just based on some of the stuff.
Was he?
He was.
Oh, that's good.
Man. Yeah, it really worked out well. But we did that a long time ago. Any lab test now can do lab testing. Any kind of lab test you need can be done there. So the paternity test is a simple mouth swab, no needles, no blood. It is valued at $500, courtesy of any lab test now. So by entering, you agree to have the results of your paternity test revealed live on the Buzz Adams Morning Show. Now, what we do not want to do is like have a father bring in a baby.
Right.
Yeah. We just don't want to open that whole kettle.
Can of worms.
Right. But this is like consenting adults. If you have any question about paternity, either as the paterfamilias or as the offspring, let Joanna know in the app chat. Get the KLAQ mobile app and tell us your story on the app chat or email me, buzz@klaq.com. buzz@klaq.com. I will read what you send in, but you can change your name or whatever. Just make sure you leave a good contact for us to get back in touch with you, especially via that app chat. All right, so that is our Father's Day paternity test, and registration is open now. Find out more on the KLAQ mobile app. Yes! Had a few more news stories to power through here before we get into the 9 o'clock hour, and a true crime report's on the way.
Yeah.
Good morning again, Nico.
Good morning again, Buzz. Well, congressional leaders from both parties have invited Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu to address a joint session of Congress. But not everyone's happy about it. Senator Bernie Sanders called out both Democrats and Republicans for welcoming someone he says is a war criminal. Talking to NBC News, Sanders mentioned House Speaker Mike Johnson by name, saying he'll have to explain to the public why he's inviting someone responsible for the death of some 38,000 Palestinians. When asked if he'd talked to Democratic Senate Majority Leader Chuck Schumer, who is also on board with Netanyahu's address, about his problems with the plan, Sanders said, "I have made it very clear to anybody who would listen."
All right.
Feel the burn. A new terror has just dropped. New terror unlocked. Experts say that Joro spiders, an invasive species of venomous spider from China that's about the size of a human hand and can fly by parasailing from their webs.
How do you spell Joro?
J-O-R-O. Should make it to New Jersey and New York this summer. Yes, giant flying venomous spiders. Experts say the spiders made it to the U.S. around 10 years ago.
Okay. It's...
Those are terrifying. Joanna, look at that.
It's the size of your hand from
that's gigantic.
One leg to another.
No,
there should be, not the size of your hand.
There should be no spider that size. Kill them all.
With fire.
Well, they made their way to the U.S. around 10 years ago on shipping containers that were delivered to Georgia. A group of researchers says that the spiders will eventually spread across the entire country. But at least there's some good news. Experts say the giant flying venomous spiders have a very weak venom. And that their fangs aren't strong enough to pierce human skin.
Oh, okay.
That doesn't mean you're not allowed to freak out when a giant venomous spider flies at your head, though.
But you don't need to, right?
But you could.
You're still
and
allowed.
And no one would judge you.
Nobody would judge you.
You know, any animal I find in my yard, like I pick up and like my daughter and I handle it, like a snail, anything like that. Uh-huh. You ever found a vinegroon? You know what a vinegroon is, Nico?
It's like a scorpion cockroach?
It looks like a monster scorpion that somebody dreamed up in a hell factory.
But they're smell like vinegar.
Yeah, they're supposed to. Yeah, I don't get freaked out, you know?
Oh, you're so brave.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you're saying, so brave.
I slept outside on the ground.
No, you didn't.
Yes, I did.
When?
Friday night and Saturday night.
Friday night, you did not, because I came over Friday night to get your butt up and put you inside.
Oh, well, I had fallen asleep outside.
Well, those are the pictures I gave to you, and you passed out outside.
I was not passed out. I intentionally laid down a pallet.
You had a beer in your hand, and you're passed out in the ground.
First of all, I don't think I had a beer in my hand. I think that's an exaggeration.
Let me look at these pictures again.
Also, it's an invasion of privacy to take somebody's picture without their knowledge and then share it with others. Does your generation not get that?
What are you going to do, sue me?
I just might.
Do it.
How cute you and your dog look outside in the backyard.
And am I holding a beer?
No. Nah. There's a cute little stuffed animal. Is that your dog's?
It's for the dog. It's Buzz's. Yeah. All right. Well, this is just for you, Buzz. So far in 2024, the National Weather Service says 100 twisters have now spun through the Sooner State. Mm-hmm. The state's tornado count between January and May is usually half of that. Oklahoma had 2 tornadoes in March, 55 tornadoes in April, and May brought 43 tornadoes.
Been a big tornado year, there's no doubt about that.
4 twisters have been EF3s and 2 have been EF4s. Have you talked to your mom?
I talk to my mom every few days. What are you talking about? Of course.
Are you sure?
Yes.
What'd she say?
I think she's telling me that she did not agree with the color of paint that they picked out for Fellowship Hall at the church.
Oh, no.
She thought they should have gone with a more neutral color.
I just don't know why they picked these bold colors. They should have gone with egg white. Eggshell.
So that's what my mom talks about. You got to listen in now. Really, really super interesting conversations.
Well, it's been more...
Oh, by the way, the thing I said about mindfulness, so I looked it up in Psychology Today. The practice of mindfulness, here's what it says about it. Mindfulness tends to evoke or reinforce what is already going on in your mind and body. If you're worried about something that will happen in the future, can't stop thinking about an event from the past, mindfulness may amplify your worrying, confusion, or suffering, could lead to a spiral of depression.
Oh, so mindfulness is just like mushrooms?
Is that what they say about mushrooms?
Set and setting. Mm-hmm. Set and setting. Tune in and tune out. Well, it's been more than a month since New Jersey's 10th District Congressman Donald Payne Jr. suffered a fatal heart attack. But last night, he won the party's primary for re-election.
Wait, who?
Donald Payne Jr.
Oh, I just heard Donald. Got my hopes up.
Payne died after the deadline had passed to remove his name from the ballot, and in the deep blue 10th district, he still won. Payne was in his 6th term when he died. Essex County Democratic leaders have reached a tentative agreement to support Newark City Council President LaMonica McCleaver, a 2-term Central Ward councilwoman who's seen as a rising star in Newark politics.
God, it's really got to rub salt in the wounds if you're the other guy.
A dead guy beat me?
Right, you got beat by a dead. They would rather have a deceased individual. They would rather have an ex-person than you as their representative.
Well, finally, a local story about a new Houston-based brunch concept that's set to enter the El Paso market after it has already filed a liquor license application with the city this week. The Toasted Yolk, a brunch concept that started in the Houston area, it looks to be ready to open its first location in El Paso. According to a filing for a liquor license, the Toasted Yolk will open at 5860 North Mesa Street in the former home of Dragonfly Wine and Sushi Bistro. Do you know where that is? Isn't that close to you?
On Mesa?
I thought that was on Donovan.
Yeah, me too. Yeah, I thought Dragon. I think they were on Donovan, and then they moved to Mesa. I think it's in one of these outdoor shopping centers.
Oh, okay.
Like a strip mall type of thing.
Are you a fan of brunch?
Sure. Yeah, I love a good brunch, I guess. Is that what they're famous for?
They're famous for brunch, and especially their namesake item, the Toasted Yolk. It is 2 slices of sourdough bread grilled with an egg in the middle of each and served with a choice of breakfast protein. Uh-huh. They're also going to offer morning favorites like a breakfast burrito, pancakes, French toast, eggs benedict. It's just cool to have a new place in town.
I guess so.
And with the news, I'm Nico.
All right. Summer is going to be here. I know it seems like summer, 104 to 107. We could get as high as 107 later today. Summer is not here until the, what did we decide, Joanna? 20th,
the
right?
The 20th.
The 20th is the first day of summer. But this is the time of year. If you're interested in picking up some non-paid hours, especially if you are studying communication, journalism, business, whatever your major is in college, consider our summer intern program.
Yeah.
So here is the pitch.
Attention. This station is looking for summer interns. Are you in college?
Yes.
Do you study communications?
No.
Do you have good grades?
No.
Doesn't matter.
Really?
Because when we look for summer interns, we look for other qualities. Like, are you hot?
Uh-huh.
Limber?
Oh, hell yeah.
Do you have a dealer?
Uh-huh.
A gag reflex?
What?
Can you grift?
I could try.
Can you hold your liquor?
Oh, yeah.
Would you get topless on a party bus? Do you think farts are funny?
Well...
Can you alphabetize CDs?
Uh-huh.
In your bikini?
Sure.
How long can you hold your breath? If you think you have what it takes, contact us today.
How's that?
And maybe tomorrow you'll be the station's new summer skin turn. Intern.
I'm Daniel Paulus, and whether you're wrapping up your workday
into clippings, Miller tools with gas-like power are perfect gifts. The Home Depot. How doers get more done.
The Buzz Adams Morning Show, Monday through Friday, 5 to 10. KLEQ and KLEQ HD1, El Paso, a Town Square media station.
I'm going to get to a true crime report. Got a crime report ready to go here in just a few minutes, but we did have a few calls and other items to talk about. You can leave us a message anytime during the show, outside the show, middle of the night, on a Saturday. It doesn't matter. That's what the neck line is for.
Yeah.
844-805-NECK. 844-805-6325. Always appreciate your calls. A few reminders. Brevity is the soul of wit. And I find that most really good quality calls don't go much longer than 45 seconds or a minute. Also, treat it like it's going to be on air, because it might be. No naughty language. Make sure you're speaking clearly. Also, we understand you a lot better if you actually talk to us not on speaker. You know, it's just one of the things, like, sometimes we'll hear a really good call, but the quality isn't good enough. It's because somebody's got it on speaker, or maybe their window's down or whatever. So that's the neckline, 844-805-NECK. Call us in the studio, and the number is 915-910-4995. That's 915-910-4995. True crime report here in just a moment. So we had a guy, we were talking about, what guy stopped talking about tipping yesterday? Remember, and then a guy called in, he's like, well, you should go back and tip the guys in the kitchen.
Yes, we had, I guess he's a cook in a kitchen, and he said that we should be also tipping them.
What was the topic about before that guy called
in?
That
is a good question.
Yeah, we were going down that road, and somebody called
and said, I think it's because on Monday that I did Best Of, there was one clip about tipping.
So a guy called in, and he's like, yeah, I'm a line cook. We never get tipped.
Right.
And I'm like, do you think you should? Yeah.
And we were like, oh my God, should we be tipping them too?
Yeah, should we be tipping the line cooks?
Well, specifically, he said, if you send an order back, you should include a tip. And I'm like, you're the first guy I'm hearing this from. Was it the first time you'd ever heard? Hey,
yes.
How about I just walk around handing out $100 bills to everybody I see? Like I'm Jimmy from Goodfellas.
To which he responded like, then you can stay home and do it yourself.
Yeah, that's right.
Hey, guys, I think the a-hole was the guy that works in that kitchen who wants a tip when he messes up your order and you send it back to the kitchen. You should give him extra money because he didn't get your food right. And then he says, his next statement is, and if you don't like the way I do it, just don't come out to eat. So I guess he doesn't want to have a job either. Boy, I don't know about the guy at the auto parts store, but that guy at the restaurant is a giant a-hole. Bye.
Oh, we had.
And then we also had that, am I the a-hole? situation.
A guy just wanted to buy some motor oil, and there was a line of people asking for specific parts, and they'd have to go in, but there was only one cashier.
Person, right.
So this guy cut the line. And the guy told him, hey, I'm going to ring you up, but in the future, you need to wait in line like everybody else. And he wanted to know if he was the a-hole.
Did he ask permission before from the person he cut in front of?
No, apparently he just made his own line.
Yeah, he just kind of went straight to the front.
Went straight to the front.
And we were all like, yeah, you're the a-hole.
I think it was nearly, some people would call in and say, yeah, sometimes you have to wait too long. Yeah, that's why there's a line. If you have to wait at all, that's what a line is.
Yeah, no. Which I said, like, the cashier could have been a bigger a-hole and told you to go to the back of the line. But the cashier didn't. He rung him up and he let him go on his merry way.
If anything, I think it's about the cashier being a proactive cashier.
But I think
so. The cashier has the one in control saying, like, look, I see some guy with one thing in the back. I'm going to get him before I get the rest of
you. Sir, come on up. Are you, you just have that stuff?
That
would be okay. But you kind of have to go by the rules of whoever's. You know,
yeah, but I know what that guy's talking about though, because I've been to, I'm not sure if they're a sponsor or not, so I'm not going to say their name.
Tell me off air. maybe not, but I do like to be on their side. And also, what the hell were you doing there?
I have things I buy from there all the time.
You're not musical at all.
I have to buy XLR cords. I have to buy speaker stands. I have to buy stuff for all my, my productions. And
so
stuff.
What are you saying?
That sometimes they'll only have one attendant.
And they're selling stuff that takes a long time to sell?
Well, there might be a line and they have like...
people who need like, we need help with this.
And you're like, or guitar. And I just have like one XLR cord that I need paid for. And like...
The place you're talking about might have one cashier, but they have several employees to help you.
No, sometimes they're all on the floor. They're doing other stuff.
Here's another call.
Hey, how you guys doing? Just listening to you guys talk about the tipping and all that, and I heard the cook call. Yeah, he's right. You know, cooks don't get paid out tips or anything like that. But I would like to ask my cook friend or any cook that works in a restaurant, when's the last time they paid for a meal? You know, they do sneak a lot of food, so every cook eats for free every day. So it's a give and take. It's a give and take. Laters. Have a good one.
Is that true? Like, if you work in a kitchen, do you just make yourself a plate?
That sounds awesome.
I worked at Pizza Hut, and you know what would happen if there was an order and the person didn't show up? Like, it was a carryout order, and the person never showed up to get their pizza?
Made you throw it away.
She looked you straight in the eye.
She made us gather around. She called everybody, the cooks. I was a driver. Everybody, I want you to watch this. This is what happens if your friends ever call in a fake order. And she would dump this delicious, hot, fresh out of the oven pizza right in the trash.
Damn.
And I would wait for her to walk away, and I would get me a slice of that pizza because that's just how I roll.
Makes sense.
No, she did. She made a big show out of dumping it right in the trash.
What a waste.
I guess that would be a perk, though, if you work in an office, I mean, in a restaurant or especially in the kitchen, can you just grab whatever you want?
I don't know. I've never worked in the kitchen.
I grab coffee when I'm here.
Should. Okay, here's a question for you. I got a couple shoulds here since we were talking about. Are we really getting to the point? Was that guy serious? He wants us to go back and tip the cooks back in the kitchen?
He sounded serious.
He did. Everything about him seemed 100% sincere.
If you don't like it, then don't go out and eat.
If you can't afford to tip the cooks. This is getting ridiculous.
They're going to turn a little iPad on us. The cook comes out.
Want your honest opinions here.
Okay.
Should women, if they want to, be allowed to go topless at water parks?
Yes. Absolutely.
I guess if they want to.
You know, I've actually always thought about this before. I've seen men walk around before and they don't wear a shirt, right? That's normal. We see that happen everywhere.
Men have nipples too.
Can you milk me, Greg? But
this is El Paso. Anybody who's carrying an extra 15 pounds is wearing a t-shirt if you're a guy.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Why, including you. Why would Why would women have to wear? Why do the women have to
what
cover up
is
boobs?
So obscene
What's
about
so obscene?
A woman's body that is not obscene
about a man's?
Free the nipple.
I mean, they're not genitals.
Yeah, no, but maybe it also has to do with the same rule of why teachers say things to girls about their dressing. You're a distraction to boys.
Because boys can't handle it.
Boys can't control themselves.
Somebody polled people on Reddit and asked if women, if they want to, should they be allowed to go topless at water parks? Beach. We don't have beaches, but, you know, the lake, maybe.
No, we have beaches.
Lots of beaches, and many of them want to go topless.
Yeah.
Like that?
Yep. A lot of topless beaches.
The argument is, if men can do it, why can't women do it? The argument against it is, well, a lot of these places have kids around. Is it appropriate for a kid to be seeing a topless woman? Around 3,000 people voted. What do you think got more votes, yes or no? Women should be allowed to go topless if they want to.
I think we're progressive. I'm going to say yes.
You're going to say most people said yes, Joanna?
Yes. Most people said yes.
By a pretty wide margin, 75% out of 3,000 people said that should be an option. If it's available for men, it should be available for women.
If a woman wants to, let her bear it all.
Oh, Joanna.
If you got a 14-year-old son, they already want to go to a water park. Now you're just incentivizing it even more.
Then you explain to your 14-year-old
exactly.
son.
You teach them.
Right.
Those are just boobs.
You teach them to don't stare too long.
You'll go blind.
Joanna,
don't give any compliments.
Joanna, I saw, I showed Buzz the Valentine's Day episode for Golden Girls
where they go to the nudist.
Terrible. Just freaking.
And he was laughing so hard.
They're looking at the ones playing volleyball. I think that's an illegal serve.
But he really liked the jokes about Rose, specifically the things that she would say.
When she's all like, don't look at me.
But it was also just so goofy and corny. There was a reason I didn't watch it when it was on.
It was amazing. It's amazing writing.
Show.
It's really
What's wrong
good.
With you?
Holds up.
Oh, boy. Yep. So here's a mom on Instagram.
Okay,
do you think anybody has a good excuse for not returning their shopping cart to the cart corral?
Is this that lady who's like, I'm a mom?
Did you hear about this?
Yes, she is getting roasted left and right on social media.
That's kind of, it didn't sound right to me, but.
Right?
How about, like an extremely elderly person, should they be able to just leave their cart? No, nobody. If you were just in a store walking around for 30 minutes, you can take 10 seconds. All right, so here's the lady on Instagram that Joanne has already heard about.
Yes.
I'm not returning my shopping cart, and you can judge me all you want.
I'm
getting my groceries into my car, getting my children into the car, and then leaving them in the car to go return the cart. So if you're going to give me a dirty look, off.
No. You, lady.
No. She is perfectly capable of returning her cart.
You were able to put that kid in a shopping cart, push it around.
Right.
Do your shopping. Check out. It's another 10 seconds. Your kid's going to be fine.
10 seconds that she says she will not leave her kid unattended in the car.
All right, fine. Then leave the kid strapped into the deal. It's just going to make him out in the heat this time of year. Put the cart up and then take the kid out of the cart.
And then take your kid out.
Right.
And then I think some
people...
You know,
it's like that old riddle. How do you get like a chicken and a donkey and a snake across a river and you've only got... You know that old riddle?
Right.
You can figure out something.
People who were defending her were saying like, well, what if she has like multiple kids and she has to take the cart back with all of them? How will she get back?
Gosh, you've got kids. You are so unique. Only like every adult on the planet is in the same boat you are.
Are you telling me like,
every single person in the history of the world has pretty much been a parent?
There's no mom or dad that can't walk 5 steps away from their car while the kids are inside to put the cart away.
Lady, if you lived 100 years ago, you would have to leave your kid while you went down to the river to get water. This, I'm a mom, therefore I'm special. I don't even think I cut that kind of slack for older folks. If you go into a store and do your shopping, ask, you know, I bet even somebody who's got a very serious medical condition makes them hard to get around. They probably ask for some help. because they don't want to leave their card out there and it's going to dent somebody else's vehicle.
Yeah, definitely. Okay. Definitely the a-hole.
definitely the a-hole.
Hey, we've got a bunch of neckline calls. I'm not sure if you've seen them. But I have a couple I wanted to.
All right. I see one here about going topless. Do you want me to play that one?
Sure.
All right. You don't preview these at all, do
I do.
You? You read them, like the descriptions, right?
That's what you do.
Hey, Buzz. Hey, Nico. Hey, Joanna. Hey, I just want to put my 2 cents in on should women go topless?
Of course.
You know, when I was younger, I always thought nude beaches and stuff would be cool. But now at my age, I'm 40 now. I'm like, the people who are willing to go topless and nude are the people you don't want to see naked. It ain't the hot model-looking people. It's usually old people, fat people. You know, you don't want to see that. Anyways, have a great day. Bye-bye.
Yeah, it's called real life.
Yeah.
I think we'd get used to it. You know,
yeah, I think that if enough women went topless, people would get used to it, just like when you see a guy topless.
Very European.
Right?
I don't think the world would stop spinning.
It's like that it's like that movie Euro Trip where they go to the nude beach and the girl's the only one there.
Girl there. And then all the guys start to chase her. That's hilarious. And then there's so much dong in that movie.
The lady who couldn't walk to take her cart back because she has multiple kids.
I think this is Cocker.
No, it's not.
How did she get there and then get a cart with her multiple kids? Did she not walk to go get it?
That's a good point. Yeah, how did you get into the store without a cart?
You don't think that's Cocker?
That is not Cocker.
No, because Cocker calls from an anonymous number. And this one has a name and number.
Hold on. Play this
one,
Buzz.
But that's a real good point, lady.
Go ahead.
So this is in response to, it's going to be Father's Day soon, and somebody asked if I was going to get Buzz a gift for Father's Day, which I'm like, no, I don't see him as a father figure whatsoever. If anything, I see Buzz as a brother/son child figure sometimes, because I'm often taking care of him.
Once again, I am your daddy.
Okay, and then Joanna's saying that she's actually both of our fathers.
Good morning, Joanna. You got to hit the boys with the Remember the Titans line. If you want to talk on this radio show, you better tell me who is your daddy. Oh, y'all have a good one.
Yeah, you better tell me who is your daddy. I want to hear you say it. Joanna is my daddy.
Also, the same person called back with a topic we were talking about.
Yo, good morning. So I got a question because I caught the whole wiener talk. Am I weird because I was about to go into Dollar General and then Nico started explaining and I stopped and listened? Does that make me weird? I mean, it is interesting, but I don't know.
Yeah, you're weird.
You know what I'm thinking. Does that make me...
Yeah. No,
of course not.
We would love for you to stay in our car to hear what we have to say.
Please, of course, yeah. You're not weird at all.
I think it does, but I hope not. Y'all have a good
I think it does.
It's not super weird.
It's not too weird.
No, that means
hey,
that we
good morning, morning show. How you guys doing? What's up, Nico? What's up, Buzz?
Hey.
Joanna?
Hey.
Stay beautiful.
Mm. Oh, thank you.
Question for you guys, and especially because this is coming up with the upcoming election. If the candidates and any like presidential candidate or whoever is talking about wanting to put the American citizens first to work on the economy, I have an idea. Why not universal healthcare? It's working great for other countries. And really, I don't think it's fair that people in America, especially those who can't afford insurance, have to pay an arm and a leg for a hospital visit. But other countries, you know, they don't need to basically, like, citizens of other countries don't need to basically go in debt to pay a hospital bill.
Ew.
I mean, I'm just saying, if you want to talk about the American citizens putting the country first, why not universal health care? What's your guys' opinion on that? All right, y'all have a good day.
My first question is, what the hell is going on with that sound?
Oh, yeah, that was bad.
Cicadas, probably. That's a good question. And listen, as somebody who's been a registered Republican my entire life, some form of nationalized health care, or as Republicans like to call it, socialized medicine, seems to be a good expenditure of money. we spend more for healthcare than any other country already. Right. And yet, you know, if you end up in a position, I paid insurance for 30 years before I ever had a major accident. And then I found out, wait a minute, I've been paying into this goddamn thing for 30 years and I can't get a free ambulance ride out of it.
Oh, yeah.
Well, what are you saying?
Yeah, that was bad.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. I'm agreeing with you.
Right. It seems like England is still a functioning country. Switzerland, Sweden, Norway, Finland, all these other places rank higher in happiness index. I think it's definitely a conversation we ought to be willing to have. But, you know, you can kind of hear, and this would come from the right mostly, why should our tax dollars be spent on the health of people that don't even have a job? That's the first place you go, is you imagine some minority that you think is lazy, and you're, why should my money go toward that? I'm just saying, I've been for having that discussion for a long time. How do we make it so there aren't long waits? You know, there are some people that are saying, well, in Canada, I don't know if they're still saying this, but they were as of a decade ago, that sometimes you're triaged. You know about triage, right?
Yeah.
They may not give you the procedure you want when you want it. So there are people.
Well, it's the basis for any emergency room. Yeah.
Okay, let's take a break. Coming up, Michael Rappaport, television movie star, and his wife, Kibi Rappaport, have a podcast where they talk about reality shows. We're going to listen and talk to them. Coming up, Michael Rappaport and his wife Kibi on the way right after this.
Hey, it's Daniel Paulus. I'll be along starting at 3 with everything from AC/DC to Alice in Chains to God.
We can recycle it. America's number one battery destination.
Get in the zone, AutoZone.
Restrictions apply.
Let there be sound. Let the commercials be over. And let there be
the Buzz Adams Morning Show.
Hey, right on, Buzz.
It's showtime. Let's kick some ass.
You got your plug on?
Hey, Mike, how you doing? Here's Mike Rapp. Mike Rappaport. Hey,
we're good.
Hey, and Kibi is here. Kibi Rappaport. Hi, guys.
Yep.
Thanks for joining us today. We're talking Rappaport reality. And I was listening to, I think, the most recent episode. Rappaport reality hosted by Kibi and Michael Rappaport talking about the greatest form of entertainment on television today. Not my words, but do you agree with that? Reality TV is the greatest form of entertainment on TV today?
I say it all the time. We say it all the time. It's 100%, in my opinion, the most consistent television. it gives exactly what the viewers want if you're into it. And in my opinion, my humble opinion, it is the greatest form of entertainment on television aside from live sports. Yes, I will say that. We stand by that. The only thing that we applaud, we will watch reality TV, The Real Housewives of Anywhere, and at times that after an episode literally clap like we're in a live show.
That's awesome.
So I'm dipping into it. It is like, so listening to the Rappaport reality is like listening to sports talk for the first time if you know nothing about sports. So they're referring to all these people, and I'm like, who is Yaya? Who is Ariana? Who is LVP? I finally figured out that's Lisa Vanderpump.
That's Vanderpump, yeah.
But it took me like two episodes to figure out who all these personalities are that you're talking about. You've probably called into sports radio before, haven't you, Michael?
I mean, all the time. I've called in, I've hosted, and yes. And that's sort of the gist of, you know, and the inspiration and the reference that we have for Rappaport's reality, aside when we're talking about ourselves and, you know, our own personal banter and, you know, highs, lows and eating habits. But yeah, we want the sort of pace and the reference of a good sports show, a part in the interruption or any of your great local sports shows, but talking about popular culture and, of course, reality TV.
Kibi, I want to ask you, is there some kind of rule, maybe not written down, maybe an unspoken rule, like certain shows you have to wait for the other to watch it?
You've got to watch it together.
If your travel doesn't allow, what do you do?
Oh, yeah. We have a rule that we don't watch shows unless we're together. So sometimes there's a problem. because I really want to get to a show and he's on the road and I have to wait. And there's sometimes an argument because I want to get to it because there's a finale and I got to wait. And this has become a problem.
But we do wait and we respect it. And it is more entertaining to watch it together.
Yes.
Because I know for me, I think Kibi will watch it solo. But like for me, you know, there's nothing better than watching it, you know, with my wife and talking about it and, you know, having our breath taken away by it.
All right, Michael, what's your favorite show? And Kibi, which one's your favorite show?
Right now, I would have to say Vanderpump Rules season 11 was great. You know, it's seasonal. So right now it was Vanderpump Rules and we both love Summer House.
Yeah, right now it would be Summer House for me. Yeah.
What describes Summer House? I'm not sure I'm familiar.
Summer House. Well, Summer House is a Bravo show. I must say, Michael, if I can speak for you, babe, he sometimes feels uncomfortable because this is a lot of young people where they go to the Hamptons just on the weekends. They're all working young people and they go share a house and there's a lot of drinking and partying.
And some of them like are our kids age. So there's some of them like they're 24. We have a 24 and a 22 year old son. So sometimes it's like, what's happening? They're actually a little older, but you know, that it is getting into that point where there might be a cutoff because like I might turn around one day and be like, wait a second. That's my, you know, so-and-so's friend. So
are you guys based mostly in LA or New York?
New York.
Yeah.
I live in New York.
Right. So which one did you say was your favorite Housewives? Like what's of all the different Housewives?
I mean, the cities, like I have to say for me, because they're the ones that got me into it, even though the show has been revamped, the Real Housewives of New York, I'll always have a soft spot for, you know, especially the women that are actually from New York. And what about you, babe?
Right now, Miami would be my favorite. Yeah.
And I know you're like, what? There's a Real Housewives of Miami,
right? I heard there's one.
I'm just going to say this. You're doing yourself a disservice by not watching the shows. Like by watching them, like you could go, oh, I'll watch it, Mike, blah, blah. You're only hurting yourself. The longer you go without watching reality TV, the longer you are missing out.
I have an admission to make, and I want to make it to the two of you because I think you're the perfect people to do it. I have watched reality TV. It always coincides to when I'm in a relationship. And that's the trade-off because I'm going to start watching the PGA on Thursday, and I'm going to watch through Sunday. And the trade-off is whatever you want to watch, we're watching it. And despite myself, you won't believe how into the 90-day fiancé universe I got.
There we go.
There you go.
That's how I fell into it, but it was through a bad day of fantasy football.
Big Ed.
I mean, you talk about the pandemic. Big Ed is a focal. That guy will go down in history of, you know, him and the Tiger King and the Michael Jordan documentary of things Big Ed saved the world during the pandemic.
I give a lot of credit to Carol Baskin and the Tiger King. All right. And the way you guys talk about it, if I can say, is almost the way wrestling fans who are in the know, like they talk about kayfabe and whether this was something you really said or whether it was a scripted thing you said. Do you get what I'm saying? It's kind of like how people talk about wrestling, which is kind of real, but kind of not real.
100%. And that's what we want to, you know, sort of bring to the podcast Rappaport's reality. And that's why we started the podcast, because we love it and we love talking about it. We love arguing about it. We love the gossip of it all and just the fun of it all and the drama of it all.
Do you know what I really miss? And just because it was such a great Reader's Digest version of everything was the soup. When they used to do the talk soup of the soup, it's like, oh, good, this is 30 minutes. I can kind of know who all these people are. Why don't you guys talk to somebody? I know you have connections and bring back the
new soup.
The new soup, and you guys can
host. New soup.
That ain't a bad idea.
If it happens, I want an executive producer credit.
Gotcha.
I'll let you know that. All right, it's Buzz. It's Buzz in El Paso, all right?
Got you.
All right, well, thank you, Michael. Thank you, Kibi. It's so wonderful to see both of you. I've got 9 cameras in this room, and not one of them could put me on the internet. So I apologize that you can if you still can't see me. It's a technological shortcut.
It's probably for the best.
You see us, right? Yeah, absolutely. Of course, good. I do.
All right, cool.
All right, love you guys. Thank you for being
with us.
All right.
Thank you so much for having us.
Appreciate it. There's Michael Rappaport and his lovely wife Kibi, and it sounds like they're just having a ball.
What a cute couple.
Yeah, aren't they?
Oh, I should have taken a picture of that, Joanna.
Oh.
Why do I think of these things right at the end?
I'm sorry. I should have thought of that, but I was busy with
weird things.
That looked crazy.
Okay, I tried to stop the commercial break, right?
Right, because I wanted to get right into the interview.
I freaked it out, I think. And it started going to the next commercial
break. And then the next one.
I think I fixed it. I think I fixed it.
You have a harder job.
No. Joanna's job is way more stressful. That room is more stressful.
Yeah, just brings stress.
We figured it out. We're fine.
So that is Rappaport
reality.
That was
so cool.
That was nice.
And they seem to have a good time, too. Everybody was right. Everybody's like, you know, Michael Rappaport is known for being
prickly.
Prickly was the word they used. I thought it was great, and I thought we related well.
Yeah.
What is a... I didn't even ask him about the Baldwins. But Joanna's going to tell us all about that.
I will.
We are going to find out about a new reality show. It's Alec Baldwin, his wife, Hilaria, whose Spanish accent has mysteriously disappeared. It's just like gone. No more Spanish accent. And they're, I don't know, like 17 kids. Are they like the Duggars? They got that many?
God, they have so many children.
They have a lot of kids.
So many of
and
them.
And
they're repopulating
count,
the world.
That doesn't even count Ireland, the thoughtless little pig.
You know what, though? You know, that may be like the lasting impression of him and her is that phone call. But I just saw pictures of them this past weekend.
And they've obviously made up.
Oh, yeah. But she has a baby now.
Oh, she does, yeah.
And so,
is that a rude, thoughtless little pig as well?
Well, that's funny.
It's definitely a little pig.
It's a little piggy. There are a lot of pictures this weekend of Alec Baldwin with his grandson, and it was adorable.
Okay. I wonder if he plays like the little toe game with the baby. This little thoughtless piggy went to market. This thoughtless little piggy stayed home. And this thoughtless little piggy went wee, wee, wee.
Hey, good morning. I was listening to the Michael Rappaport interview,
yeah.
And you know, not as an insult, but he looks exactly what he sounds like, even through the radio.
Mm-hmm.
Like I can just see his face and his squinting. You know, I can see it, and in the kind of pasta, I don't know, looks like a foot. All right, guys.
What did he say? What was that last part, Joanna?
His face looks like a pata?
I don't know.
Tiene cara de pata. I don't know. Looks like a foot.
He
looks like a foot. Who, Michael Rappaport does?
What?
Well, right. Definitely not Kibi.
No, Kibi's gorgeous.
You know, between him and Paul Scherer, who you got to interview last week, the week before.
I want to remind everybody of my New Year's resolution 2024.
Mm-hmm.
Book more interviews.
Better interviews.
Get better, bigger name guests.
And you've been doing it.
I think you've been doing a good job at that.
And so between Michael Rappaport and Paul Scherer...
Who you called Rob.
Stop. I think they do bit parts in almost every television show that I've ever seen.
Yeah. Like Rappaport would show up on definitely a lot of like primetime dramas.
Yeah, and just as a random villain or a sidekick or this or that.
Very versatile actor, for sure.
Did you know, though, that Michael Rappaport started in stand-up comedy at 19 years old?
Really?
Yeah, and his father was the co-owner with Bud Freeman of the Improvs.
Wait, his...
I knew you would be interested in this, but you were reading.
His father was Bud Friedman's partner?
Yes.
Okay.
For the Improvs.
I didn't know any of that.
Yeah.
Artist interview. Zoo Music Discoveries. Celebrating artists' birthdays. Commemorating releases. Champion of all things rock.
Fatigue, low energy, and amazing massage chairs. Now open. Book now and get 50% off your first service in June.
Live from the KLAQ studios, the Buzz Adams Morning Show. Courtesy of Blasheen, Vias, and Enderman Personal Injury Lawyers. At GVILaw.com.
All right, we're almost out of time. We're going to start wrapping things up. Nico is going to be out tonight.
I am.
He's going to be at Silo Bar. What do you got going on at Silo?
I've got awesome trivia that I will be hosting, and it is going to be at Silo Bar, 7 p.m. tonight. It's at the substation. It's the corner of Sunset and Donovan on the west side. They've got delicious food, like some of the best food I've ever had.
Gorgeous bar. Like
really
the bar
amazing bar.
It's like a million-dollar bar.
Like
it's
old,
just so
old
cool.
Oak wood, and like it sounds like, it looks like a place that would have whiskey, which I don't, they do.
They definitely do. Whiskey,
yeah. $5 30-ounce Guinness tonight, and Bob Baja Tacos, plus I'm giving away $25 to Buffalo Wild Wings. I've given away a gift certificate to Silo Bar, as well as some t-shirts.
Wait, this is bingo or trivia?
This is trivia.
Okay.
Yeah, for the top three winners.
Jacob Esparza dropped by, who's also a comic sometimes, and Jacob wanted to say hi to the girls at Charlie Clark Nissan.
Yeah, Jacob Esparza. Brr, 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 brr.
Do you want to say hi or not?
Oh, yeah. I want to shout out to...
What's wrong with you?
Susie Salas, the intake girls. I'll be bringing tires real soon.
The intake girls at Charlie Clark Nissan.
Yeah, they're the...
You deliver the tires to them.
Yes.
Okay.
And they listen every day.
Oh, yeah?
Yes, sir.
Fat tires?
No, thin ones.
Get ready, girls. Jacob's coming in with some tires.
With some thin-ass tires.
Look at the rubbers.
I got a call or two here. Joanna's got some great articles. These articles ought to be like President's Club level.
Yeah.
Hey, good morning. On the issue about, you know, them doing an arena and multiple event venues, how about fixing the streets first? I mean, I know that there's a lot of construction on I-10 and on the interstate, but some of the streets out here in the city, they're horrible. It's starting to look like Juarez now. Come on now. Have a good day, Mo Show.
Actually, I was going to say, so on the west side on Mesa by Coronado High School in front of it.
Well, they've got that road torn up because they're replacing it.
Well, that's what I'm saying is they've kind of finished one way going down Mesa towards the upper valley, or I guess going up into the upper valley. They finish on the right side, and it is way smoother. Like Mesa is, it is better having been repaved. I'm not sure how much damage it has done to the other businesses around there, and just from being
here's a very specific road thing. And we were talking about how the county does not necessarily want to spend $99 million on the Sun Bowl. They'd rather spend it on the county coliseum, all this other stuff. Like the paint on roads that let you know, wait a minute, is this a left turn lane or is it a left turn and a street? Are so faded all over town in different neighborhoods. You got to be a mind reader to figure out like the lines on the road that let you know that you're in the right lane.
Are you sure you're not faded?
No. Everybody else that drives in El Paso notices this.
Yeah, just stay on the right-hand side.
How much is a little paint to repaint the directions on the road?
No, now they like vinyl them down and like set them on fire. They melt it to the floor. Have you seen that?
What?
What?
Yeah, they lay down these big vinyl sheets and then they just blowtorch them and they're supposed to stick forever, but... They come off in one.
Interesting.
There have been times when I've been like, I'm in the second to the left lane. I assume this is a turn lane. I guess we'll find out as soon as I go through the light because I can't see the paint on the floor. So tell me if anybody else, and this is pretty hardcore nerd stuff, but you can relate if you're a hardcore enough nerd. Yesterday, a new Star Wars series called The Acolyte started airing on
Star Wars. Oh, I was supposed
Star
to
Wars.
Ask you about this. That's right. Have you watched The Acolyte yet, Buzz?
So, I went home to turn it on.
Uh-huh.
And it ain't there.
What do you mean it ain't there?
What do you mean it ain't there?
I think if you say something's going to be out on, for instance, June the 4th, It needs to go on at midnight on June the 4th.
Oh, no, it might be like so, later that night on June the 4th.
I was so pumped up. I went and got Taco Bell. I was really going to celebrate this new Star Wars show. It's like,
you got Taco Bell.
It was like, it hasn't started yet. When's the start date? June 4th. So every 30 minutes, Joanna, not a joke, every 30 minutes, I'm clicking on the Disney app.
Really? It wasn't already there?
It wasn't until dark before it finally showed up. And guess what happened?
What's that?
I fell asleep within the first 15 minutes.
Although I did. I asked him if he liked it.
The site crashed from everyone trying to watch it once.
And he said, you know, I was kind of falling asleep, so I'm not sure. I think it was badass.
A lot of people are saying it is pretty badass. First two episodes are up.
All right, here is the premise. The Acolyte is set at the end of the Star Wars franchise's High Republic era. Approximately...
I can tell you this.
Approximately 100 years before Phantom Menace.
So every planet has their own Jedi, who's kind of like the local magistrate. And the scene opens with this young person who's can use the Force. Where's your Jedi? It's like, where's your Jedi? So this is like a generation or two before Darth Vader was born, right?
100 years before Phantom Menace.
Carrie Ann Moss is in it. Boy, should I save it for spoiler?
All right, how about I just finish this premise?
Yeah, all right.
It sees a respected Jedi master investigating a series of crimes that bring him into contact with a former Padawan learner and reveals sinister forces.
So the Jedi, the respected Jedi leader, is the Squid Game guy. The guy from Squid Game.
Nice.
He learned English.
It's terrible. Well, people are saying that it requires zero knowledge of Star Wars history, really, to enjoy. So that's nice.
Just as a heads up, couldn't they say, like, put a countdown clock on it? Like, if you got your episode, but it's not going to air until sometime later in the day, just say, hey, new episode airs and Netflix. I feel like I'm paying enough money to get a little specialized service like that.
It's not on Netflix.
Disney Plus, excuse me. Disney Plus, Netflix, you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah,
Disney Plus. Instead, I'm going back every 30 minutes.
And then you fall asleep.
Is it all? And then when it's finally on, I fall asleep. I plum tuckered myself out trying to find the new Star Wars show on Disney Plus. All right, we got to wrap things up, everybody. Thank you to actor Michael Rappaport and TB Rappaport for being on with us today. Thanks for the McDonald's sandwiches.
Sandwiches
from BK.
Oh, don't you dare.
Don't you dare, sir. It's a croissant sandwich.
Oh, I thought that was a McDonald's bag. That's a BK bag.
Yeah, sandwiches.
Yeah, Burger King does have the best breakfast. I mean, that's my feeling anyway. Yeah, how about the ham, egg, and cheese croissant sandwich? You ever tried that one?
I think that's the one that's in there.
Well, they're delicious. All right.
Was that fun?
Yeah.
That was fun.
You've been listening to the Buzz Adams Morning Show.
Okay, enough mayhem. Thank you. We got